Hello?
We're on to Cincinnati.
You play to win the game.
It was all that Dan Marino's fault. Everyone knows that.
When it's too tough for them, it's just right for us.
Covering the New England Patriots, Miami Dolphins, New York Jets, and the Buffalo Bills.
180! 180!
Kyle Smith.
What kind of defense is it? Because they're disguising their coverage as late. Julio Jones, Chris Hogan, identical stat line.
Gary Smith.
Percy Harvin threw a dumbbell at him, Kyle, in the weight room. Kyle, please, my butt.
AFC East Bros Podcast.
Yes, yet another episode, AFC East Bros. Kyle and Gary, just as the intro says, we're talking all things in the AFC East. We do this every single week. No breaks in between. Every Tuesday, unless something happens, you're going to have an episode of AFC East Bros. Because the NFL news never stops. And some of these podcasts, they might slow down a little bit in the off season, maybe take 2-3 weeks off here or there. Not the case with us. And there's a couple reasons. Partly is because we love doing it. Another thing is because we've got four teams to talk about, and the news just never dies. The discussion never dies. And it's free agency now, Gary. The first week is just it's a couple days in the books already. The big wave is already surpassed. Now starting to get into that second wave. You're starting to see a little bit more value for the contracts. And we had some interesting signings, Gary. And I'll let you say what you have to say about some of those signings.
Yeah, I mean, particularly in the division, Kyle. Now, let's face it, there's still a lot of big whales out there. Dante Hightower is still on the market. Dontari Poe still on the market. You still got a lot of players that are available that are big-name free agents. In fact, two of those names I just mentioned have been linked to two AFC East teams. Dontari Poe has a visit scheduled with the Miami Dolphins, which – I am dreading that at this point, because imagine with him and Sue on the same D-line. And Dante Hightower, Kyle, has been rumored to the Jets. In fact, had a nice visit where the Jets showered him with birthday gifts and cupcakes and name on the
– presents for mama, too.
Presents for mama. I mean, they were remind me of the Mario Williams visit years ago with the Bills, you know. Block the tarmac.
I remember that year. You're like, yeah. What's his name? Good old Buddy Nix. He's like, we got to spend a cap this year.
Yeah. Well, you know, and it paid dividend for the Bills. I mean, obviously you don't get that much when you pay someone that much money, you're never going to find the value, but he had 3-4 tremendous years with the Bills. So, it definitely worked. Anyway, I was quite pleased with the Bills did. We got a lot of bargain guys. We didn't go and go after the big whales. Those two names I just mentioned, you know, the Alshon Jeffries, Stephon Gilmore, Kyle, that's one of the big whales that was out there. He did get paid by an AFC East team, but it wasn't the Buffalo Bills. In fact, our bitter rivals, the New England Patriots, they went out and they got one of the best press man corners in the game. And, you know, there's a lot of people that were speculating because of that championship game with the Atlanta Falcons, what Julio Jones was able to do, that they wanted a bigger physical corner. And they got Stephon Gilmore. Now, the jury's still out. I've said this before. I don't think he is. I think he's in the discussion as a top five. I think he's more of the top 10. But he sure got paid like a top five corner.
Most definitely. I mean, you look at this contract, compare it to Darrelle Revis' contract from 2 years ago. Revis had $37 million in guaranteed money, and he had $70 million over the 5 years. Now, while Gilmore might not have as much total, I do wonder how the cash flow is broken down. Obviously, whenever you sign a contract, you want as much money as you can get early on, because – it's more likely that you're going to get that money if the contract's not backloaded. You're most likely to get cut in your latter years. So maybe he's got a little bit more cash flow up front, but definitely he does have a couple more $1 million more in guaranteed money. Obviously, he's younger than Revis, but certainly didn't have the pedigree. And a lot were saying that Gilmore came off a down season last year. I know the interception numbers were up, but you know he was beaten here or there, fell out of favor a little bit in a lot of Bills fans' mind. It was pretty much a consensus among Bills fans. You know, we shouldn't really retain him at this point.
Yeah. And once again, Kyle, I've said this day one, it depends on who they come in and they hire. And when Sean McDermott was announced, immediately, when you look into his what defensive scheme he likes to run, the value's not there. It's not justified to spend that much money in a corner because, you know, you look at a guy like Josh Norman. Okay, goodbye, Josh Norman. We let him walk. They don't like putting a lot of money into that position. And especially when you run a zone scheme, you don't need a big press corner to get in there and jam the receivers and stick the guy throughout the whole length of the field. You just don't need that guy. And that's why you saw two guys in Sean McDermott's scheme kind of walk, Josh Norman and Stephon Gilmore. And they both got paid hefty. I'm assuming that Stephon Gilmore is going to thrive in New England, just like Josh Norman had a pretty good year in Washington. The talent is there, but it just doesn't warrant in this scheme that to put that much capital into that position doesn't warrant.
Yeah, I mean, and the Patriots, we talked about how they have so much cap this year. This could be the year that not only could they maintain their in-house guys, Butler, Hightower, et cetera, but they could also go out and make a couple of big splashes. And they're a team, like, you know, we've said we're not a fan of going out and spending big in free agency. It's really never gotten our teams anywhere. But the Patriots is a different story. New England fans every year, they always know that their team is one of the best teams. Why don't we go out and spend like it, give Brady as much help as possible? Because we don't know what is the future to be. We're not in rebuild. We're in win now mode. Absolutely. So the Patriots, you know, with a contract like this, it's a little bit unconventional. We're starting to see a couple things are very uncharacteristic of the Patriots. Giving up a first round pick for Brandon Cooks. I mean, the Patriots have always been the organization that would switch out some of their guys to acquire a first-round pick. You know, Richard Seymour won a couple Super Bowls with the Patriots, was an absolute force. He was still good at that point in which they traded him, but they traded him to the Oakland Raiders for which was, I believe, a top 10 draft pick at the time. I believe that draft pick ended up being Gerard Mayo, if I'm not mistaken. So this is certainly uncharacteristic, and it's led some people to speculate that maybe, just maybe, this is, you know, Tom Brady's either retiring or it's one of the last hurrahs for Belichick.
Well, it's definitely, Kyle. I mean, like I said, I know you and I sound repetitive when we say this, but even New England fans know at this point, given the age of both Bill Belichick and Tom Brady, how much longer can this go on? And seriously, I think that's why they're throwing all their chips into this year. And Kyle, not only are they the odds-on Super Bowl favorite, given their roster and their current, you know, the talent that's on that team, they're also, you know, if you look at the schedule, they could possibly go push for an undefeated season this year. I don't want to say that, but, you know, given the talent they have on that team right now, if they could retain Hightower, they could somehow make Malcolm Butler happy and not lose him. And kind of keep in mind, those two guys could walk away and they won't skip a beat, I don't think, either. This defense, this draft is such loaded with defensive players that the New England Patriots could replenish like that. So I don't think losing Butler or Hightower will be a big loss for the New England Patriots.
Not only that, but if you lose Butler, you're getting, let's say the Saints, for example, he's visiting them as we speak. That's the 11th overall draft pick. You could potentially draft O.J. Howard there. Charles McDonald, who I just got word from him, this big storm, his power went out. He's not going to be able to make it tonight. We'll get him on a future week to talk interior defensive line in the draft. But, you know, he had sent out a tweet earlier today, and he said, I don't want to envision a world in which the New England Patriots have O.J. Howard on their roster in addition to Gronk. I mean, could you imagine those two big beasts running over the middle? You got Brandon Cooks scooting underneath.
I don't think – with the addition of Dwayne Allen, I don't think that that's going to be a possibility. But I definitely think they get one of the top wide receivers in the draft. And a name like you know, I don't know, Mike Williams, a big body wide receiver. You know, they have a bunch of quick small guys out there in Edelman, Amendola. But if they could get a big time red zone threat like that, that would scare me.
Yeah, and shoot, I mean, if they have that 11th overall pick, you know, some people talk about Reuben Foster maybe sliding a little bit. If you lose Hightower, maybe you replace him with another Alabama linebacker. A lot of people are saying that he has a higher upside than Hightower. You know, he certainly is in terms of where he's positioned in the draft. Like, you know, Hightower was at something in the 21st overall pick, something like that. Whereas, you know, Reuben Foster, a lot of people saying, you know, he's got top five type of talent in a very loaded draft class. So, I mean, the Patriots, when you are in a position of strength like them, where they don't need to go out and sign big every year, and they never lose contract negotiations. Like, for example, guy who you think is absolute trash, Mike Maccagnan, he's lost a couple times. These contract stalemates, he's lost. He lost the Fitzpatrick one. He lost that one. Darren Lee was going to hold out. Maccagnan caved in and gave him all the guaranteed money that he wanted. So this has happened with Maccagnan on a couple occasions. Doesn't really happen with the Patriots with their own guys. And because Malcolm Butler is a restricted free agent, they're using that leverage against him right now. Hey, listen, Malcolm, you can go and play for your $3.9 million this year, but you're 27 years old and you might get hurt. And they're exercising that leverage as much as possible. But he is a good player, though, that teams are willing to you know, look into him. There's another team that's also considering signing him. I can't think of who it is at the moment.
The Texans, Kyle, have been rumored too.
The Texans, which is interesting, Gary, because you had Boye, and you didn't want to pay him. But to pay Butler, you figure Butler, he's produced more seasons. You know, he's been a Pro Bowl-ish type of corner for the past two seasons, where Boye only had one season of that. So you have to figure if Butler, you know, he probably would want a bigger contract than Boye, but you'd have to also give up a draft pick, a premium draft pick, to get him 27th overall in a very good draft class. That doesn't make much sense to me.
You know what, though? Like I said, the biggest thing that scared me about Boye was just the one season he had, the one season of productivity. I think maybe the Texans also looked at that as well. Kyle, it also could be some remorse, too. Maybe they're like, shoot, we should have paid Boye. Now let's go out and try to get a corner. We could still right the wrong and go out and get a pretty good corner in this league in Malcolm Butler. And I think Butler is a goner, no doubt about it. I think that he'll be moved before the draft. And, you know, obviously the ransom is going to be pretty high for him. You know, here's the Super Bowl hero a couple of years ago. Here's a guy who's been played pretty well. So, and you know what? You know, even though he's pretty old for you know, the amount of years he's been in the league, he's still only 27. So that's a solid three, four years you're going to get out of him.
You also have to wonder, too, like, all right, he's 27, but is he considered a young 27 because he hasn't played in the league as many years?
Oh, well, that's an interesting point you bring up. You know, I guess everyone's body's different. You know, you look at a kid that came out of South Carolina a couple of years ago, Marcus Lattimore. Here's the guy who had all the talent in the world, one of the best running backs. You know, he drew comparisons to Adrian Peterson. I mean, and then he tears his knee up. He's never the same player. He's walking with a limp the rest of his life, you know, and that kid's only 22 years old. So one injury can age you real fast.
Yeah. We're going to be really draft-centric going forward, but
free agency. I mean, we got some names.
Tons to talk to this week, and, you know, shoot. Because
we're not into the draft yet.
Yeah, and we'll have some weeks we'll probably have two draft guys on for 40-plus minutes each. So let's talk more about the game. I mean, Gary, obviously they overpaid, but, I mean, if Butler does go elsewhere, you think he's going to go elsewhere, and let's say Gilmore is the replacement, because you also lost Logan Ryan. I mean, he went to Tennessee for about $10 million a year. Is Gilmore in the Patriots system an upgrade over Butler?
That remains to be seen. I think Butler does things better than Gilmore, and Gilmore does things better than Butler. To which I don't know how it's going to pan out in New England. All I could say is that that's a pretty good corner they got. I think overall, Kyle,
I think you could do more with Gilmore than you can with Butler. That's my personal opinion. I think that you look at some of the matchups he's had over the years. I always like to bring up the DeAndre Hopkins matchup. You know, here's a guy that virtually shut him down. He shut down Odell Beckham when they met the Giants last year. A.J. Green did not have good stat lines against Gilmore could take out a team's best receiver. And he does it by being physical. He does it by getting in their head. He's not a guy that likes to trash talk. He'll usually say one line a game. He'll just say all day. And he usually gets enough to get in their head. Whereas Butler, he'll give up big plays. He'll get beat. He'll get constantly beat by that same guy. So I like that Gilmore has a more physical skill set. I think that Butler makes better plays in the ball. Butler would probably be better in a zone scheme than as opposed to Gilmore. He's a smaller guy, a little bit more twitchy. But Gilmore, in a straight line, is faster. He's definitely the more physical. He's the better tackler.
Yeah, Butler's a 4'6 guy.
Yeah, there's Gilmore has, and he has more upside. And he's also the younger player, Kyle. He's been in the league a little bit longer than Butler, but he's the younger player.
Yeah, it is interesting. It's just, you know what's interesting is when the Patriots were in contract negotiations last year with Malcolm Butler, they told him, and they were giving him like a $6, $7 million offer at the time, as per the reports. And they said to him, we're not going to pay a corner $10 million a year. Well, they went out and gave Gilmore about $14 million a year.
Yeah. Like I said, I think Butler feels slapped in the face, and I would too. You know, here's the guy who basically won them a championship. I mean, that game was all Seattle's. All they had to do was, if he didn't make a play on that slant, that's a touchdown right there. And Butler had the know-how to recognize it and go right after that ball. Maybe another corner wouldn't have done that. Or another corner wouldn't even have picked it off. Maybe would have just batted down. But at least they give Seattle another chance to punch it in. I don't know. I'm just speculating. But all I'm saying is that Butler's been a New England guy. He's homegrown talent. And it's kind of disheartening because, you know, you look at guys like Miguel, someone that we have on our show a lot. He even said that's my favorite current New England Patriot player to watch. So a lot of New England fans love Malcolm Butler. They love him. And to go out and get Stephon Gilmore, you know, a guy who plays for the opposing team in your division. You know, it's kind of disheartening, I would say.
I mean, how could you not love Malcolm Butler? I mean, shoot, you're not winning that Super Bowl against Seattle if it's not for him. And think about it. That's three Super Bowls that you lost since the last one that you won, if you do lose that game against Seattle.
No, I know. And it'd be a big loss to lose Butler. Now, I think New England had the goal to keep him. And it's just not going to work out. Butler does not want to be there, I don't think. And I think New England knows that the end result is they might as well get something because we're going to lose this kid.
The one thing that's is just a constant with the Patriots is they obviously appreciate what players have done to them, but they're never going to let that cloud their judgment on what's going to be best going forward. Yeah, Butler, you've done these things for us, but we're in a position of strength now. And the fact is we thought Gilmore – and they probably have to think Gilmore has higher upside. There's no way that you give him that type of contract based on what he's previously done.
No.
If you don't think that he's got higher upside. But the fact is he was an unrestricted free agent. Malcolm Butler is restricted. And they're looking at it now like, hey, listen, this draft class, we had a bad draft pick or we had a lower-end first-round draft pick anyway. We'll take a first-rounder from Malcolm Butler. And – you know, if we can get him for a cheap deal because he's an unrestricted free agent, then we'll do it. They always are in a position of power, and they always do have the long-term options in mind anyway. And it's, you know, what you said before, you know, who's going to be better? You said it remains to be seen who's going to be better. And this is the Belichick effect. You know, Malcolm Butler, part of the reason he's probably become the player that he's become is because he's only ever been a New England Patriot. You know, he's not a very big guy. He's not even a fast guy. He's a 4'6 guy. And for comparison, Tease Tabor, who some people were saying is potential top five, top 10 draft pick, if you were to read mock drafts about a month ago, highly touted player coming out of the University of Florida, He runs a 4.63 at the combine. Now they're saying second, third round for him. That's slow for a corner. Malcolm Butler's in that speed range. So, you know, a guy with that skill set and size, if he's developed somewhere else, how good does he become? Gilmore, maybe not getting the best coaching out there. All of a sudden you throw him into a good system. How much better can he be? So it's certainly going to be really interesting going forward.
Yeah. You know, and like I said, I think that, you know, moving quick on from Gilmore is that he's going to thrive in that New England system. They got a good corner in Stephon Gilmore. Kyle, you know that I've been champing for him all last year. Year before that, the whole Darrelle Revis thing. When I saw the news that he got picked up by New England, I was completely disgusted. Yeah. Completely disgusted. So, congrats, New England. You got a good corner, and Stephon Gilmore. Yeah, I don't wish any bad in your life, but I hope you get torched week in and week out.
I saw you retweeting. You know, people who said that Sammy Watkins is going to torch him. And
well, that was our boy Action Jackson. That was a Dolphins fan.
Yeah, he's a fan of Sammy for sure. I don't think he's very high in Gilmore either. If I can
remember, well, I could tell you this right now. Every report I read at camp that Gilmore cannot cover Watkins. You know, there'd be matchups where maybe he won, but majority of the time that Watkins will leave him in the dust. But
no, that's going back to his rookie year too.
Yeah, I don't think there's many corners that could really match up with Sammy one on one with his athleticism. They'd have to bracket a guy like that. But don't get me wrong. Yeah, Gilmore is one of the better corners in this league. I was just completely disgusted he went to New England. But let's move along, Kyle.
Your feelings of disgust were probably similar to my feelings of disgust when New England signed Darrelle Revis back in 2014.
And you're almost like, how could you do it? But let's move on. There's plenty of free agents to talk about.
Let's talk about the Dolphins a little bit then. So their plan, they wanted to maintain a lot of in-house guys.
They did it.
Kenny Stills, there was a lot of debate back and forth. He's going to come on later on. I know he's going to get on me. I'm already prepared for it. That's Joe Blewett, Mr. Controversial.
You were. By the way, I'm glad you brought this up because I think you. I have some of your tweets I'm going to repost about the Tyrod Taylor situation.
You want to get into that right now?
Well, you're already talking about the Dolphins, but you got to eat a lot of crow, my friend. And probably one of the most saltiest guys on Twitter is my brother Kyle. He's constantly talking about the Tyrod Taylor situation. And I'm telling you, my man's got stock in Morton Salt because that is one of the saltiest men he's looking on right now on the screen. Salty, salty, super salty.
I'm salty for a couple reasons. I'm one of those saltine crackers. Here's why. I'm salty because you're looking at a guy who is a potential. I like to think that there is room for growth with him. How can there not be? He's a two-year starter. That's it. He's 27 years old. How can there not be room for growth with him? So you're looking at if he were to hit the open market, you can sign a guy without having to give up a draft pick who could potentially turn into a franchise quarterback. So obviously I wanted him, even though I knew the odds were very, very slim. Said that multiple times on here. So I'm obviously disappointed about that. But then the saltiness continues because – I'm kind of upset for him, but at the same time, he's a darn fool. Why the heck would you take a $10 million pay cut? I'm telling you. And apparently, Rodak, ESPN, said in an article that his agent, Adisa Bukhari, if I'm pronouncing his name correctly, he said that he kind of had like informal talks with teams, and he didn't think that Tyrod would get more elsewhere, which to me is mind-boggling because Glennon, Napoleon Dynamite, got more guaranteed money going forward than Tyrod Taylor.
But that's comes to our discussion last week. Teams talk, Kyle, that supposed tampering day, that illegal tampering day is complete BS. They talk well before then. So Tyrod probably got a good indication what his market was going to be like well before he even redid the deal with the Bills.
But there can't be formal talks, though. So you have to wonder, because it's not
formal. But that's – all right. It's not formal. But an agent could talk to – I'm telling you, agents have a way of talking to teams, and they have information leaked out already. I'm telling you, Kyle. It happens.
But it's not into an actual bidding war, though, at that point. So you for have example, to wonder what – go ahead.
My agent – I'm a big-time NFL player. My agent – I play for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. I'm a quarterback, and all of a sudden, I'm about to be a street free agent. My agent's going out, and he's already talking to representatives from Tennessee. What do you think you would give my guy? I'm telling you, Kyle, it happens well before that. He already has a ballpark figure in his head before they even get to the table. I'm telling you that happens.
He might have a ballpark, but teams start to ante up. Once they see, oh, shoot, our guy, you know, people, this team is, you know, get in on the Tyrod sweepstakes as well. Let's start to ante up our offer.
At the same token, the agent's going back to that team. Hey, Tampa, Tennessee saying this, Chicago saying this, and he's doing the same thing. He's saying, "Hey, Tennessee, Chicago, they're playing the game, Kyle. That's what these agents are. They're complete vultures, and they're already chomping at the bit."
Wouldn't you say some agents are stupid?
There's a fool born every second, Kyle.
Haven't we seen this agent be a fool in the past? Because when we had Miguel on last summer about the Tyrod contract, which he had signed at that point, Miguel said this is a phenomenal deal for the Bills, to which both of us agreed.
Once again, but Joe and I, we agreed on this point. Sometimes you can't factor into what a team and what an organization represents to that individual
person. I guarantee you, Joe.
I can tell you right now, Dante Hightower does not want to be a New York Jet.
I agree with that, and he shouldn't. But let's.
He's hoping he does not want to be in those ugly green and white jerseys. He wants to be a New England Patriots. And I'm telling you right now, the Jets,
as he should.
The Jets are throwing the most money at him. Make no bones about that, Kyle.
All right, let me.
They're giving him cupcakes. They're giving him parades. I'm telling you, they're lining his grandma and his mom up with all these gifts. Joe Namath's daughter is being thrown out. Everything's being thrown at this man right now. But he does not want to bite because he's hoping that he could take maybe a little bit less, just like Tyrod Taylor did, to be where he's at.
Oh, but
don't you get the correlation right there?
Oh, but because you know what? Buffalo is the model of success. You know, if I'm Tyrod, I want to stay. I want to be. Don't cut me off. Don't cut me off. I did not cut you off. That's not.
He's playing with the number one rushing offensive line, the number one rushing team. He's got Sammy Watkins. He's got Charles Clay. He's got a lot of familiar faces to him right now. It's better than going to Chicago or Cleveland or the Jets right now.
Is it better when you factor in that you could be getting a lot more in guaranteed money going forward and that you can be getting a lot more annually going forward? Is it better then? And we like to make fun of Cleveland, but Cleveland's got a plethora of draft picks too. You bring Tyrod in there, you got your quarterback situation solved. If you're Tyrod, what's been Cleveland's biggest problem over the last decade and a half? Quarterback.
Then why isn't Dante Hightower signing with the Jets? I guarantee there's more guarantees more annual on the table.
But you can't make this comparison. You're trying to equate the Buffalo Bills to the New England Patriots. The Patriots is a different story. Buffalo Bills haven't made the playoffs in 17 years. The Patriots are in the AFC Championship game.
We're talking about familiarity.
Apples to oranges.
Oh, okay. We've seen this with other players too, besides Don Terry Poe, all right? Listen, another prime example. We'll go back to last season. Derek Wolfe. Derek Wolfe took a joke of a deal. And his running mate got paid by Jacksonville 10 times more than he did, Malik Jackson. Now, once again, Derek Wolfe said in an open statement, "I want to be in Denver. I like the area. I like my teammates." Case closed, Kyle. You see it all the time in the NFL.
Why would any player sign before their – why would any player re-up with their team before –
Money. Simple. You're a man. You're a businessman. You're about the bottom dollar to a certain extent. Why the heck? This is stupid. This is asinine. The Tyrod Taylor, he probably could have gotten $40-something million guaranteed if he went somewhere else.
You don't know that.
Harry, that statue, Mike Glennon, who started 13 games as a rookie.
You don't know that.
He got $30-something million guaranteed, $14-something million annually.
Kyle, you're right. All these quarterbacks are getting picked up left and right. Mike Glennon's the only one who really got picked up. Oh, I'm sorry. Nick Foles got signed.
Gary, are we really going to equate and compare Tyrod to Glennon, Foles, Barkley? Gary, come on. I know you're a Bills fan, but your defense
also right here is too fanboyish. Kyle, listen. Can you listen to me? Stop being so stop being so salty because your Jets missed out yet again and you were so butthurt because of that. I'm telling you right now, you were the biggest guy stomping on Twitter. I can't wait for Tyrod. This is what the Jets – would the Jets trade their 39th pick? Oh, boo-hoo-hoo, didn't happen. Good luck with Josh.
Did I ever say it would happen?
Good luck with Chase Daniels.
It's Daniel. I already corrected you once about that.
Daniels, McCown, good luck.
And Gary, it's a foolish deal for Tyrod. And just because you're a Bills fan – Gary,
no, you're salty. I'm giving
credit to your team. Your team.
What I'm saying, why
stop cutting me off?
Kyle, you cut me off twice, so don't even start. Next time, I'm going to tell you this right now. Why would any unrestricted free agent sign before they're about to hit the open market? Answer that question.
If I was an unrestricted free agent, I wouldn't.
Okay, but that's what I'm saying. They do it all the time. So you're making this dumb argument, but the guy's doing.
He took a pay cut, Gary. It's not even the same thing. He took a pay cut.
He wanted to be with the Bills. That was his answer.
Okay, but it's a foolish.
Okay,
it's a foolish move on his part.
You could smell the greed coming off my brother right now. It's a foolish,
Gary. Take it however you want it. I'm saying your team made a good deal. Kudos to the Bills. I said that multiple times. If you think this was a smart business deal on Tyrod Taylor's end, then you are a fool.
Listen, we're not talking about dollars right now. And who's to say that he would have made that money? You keep saying that he would have, but you don't know that for a fact. You don't.
I find it really hard to believe. And I think many other people really find that hard to believe.
That's fine. There's a lot of guys out there right now can't even find work.
And I think you find that hard to believe too, even though you might not want to admit it.
Because Kyle, I'm telling you, his agent poked around.
His agent's a fool because the last contract he took was stupid as well. If he had waited one more year, Tyrod probably would have gotten even a bunch more on the open market.
You don't know it for a fact. And I'll continue to say that. You don't know that. I don't know.
And we heard multiple reports that multiple teams were willing to give Tyrod Taylor contract offers. They had them prepared.
Like I said, he was also available for trade. We didn't see anyone pony up a trade pick for him.
Yeah, but a trade is a totally different story. Kirk Cousins could be up for trade. We see
once again. Let's see a team pony up for the pick, and then I'll see the interest. We're hearing all these rumors, Kyle, but no one is actually stepping up to the plate.
Trades are really complicated because not only you could trade
really for a player. New England's made three already. So
when we're talking quarterbacks, how often do we see big time quarterbacks getting traded?
Pretty rare. 2 years ago, we saw a quarterback for a quarterback swap. We've seen them, Kyle.
It's pretty rare.
I will give you that. But guess what? There's only one quarterback on 32 teams at start. So,
kudos to the Bills. Tyrod Taylor financially is a fool. Simple as that. And I think you need to admit that.
Whatever you want to say, Kyle, you don't know that what the teams were offering him.
Because, listen, I get it if you're Tom Brady. Tom Brady, listen, I want to stay with Belichick. I won multiple Super Bowls with Belichick. I like winning, and I can be here and win for a long time. Tyrod hasn't had a winning season with Buffalo. Buffalo hasn't been in the playoffs in 17 years. So, yeah, he might like throwing to Sammy, but Sammy's hurt a lot. He might like Charles Clay, but Charles Clay is Charles Clay. Who's your second, third, and fourth option? Come on, give me a break.
But then again, you're talking about the teams that were interested in are teams like Cleveland and the Jets, even worse rosters than the Bills.
But if the money's there, it offsets that.
But you don't know if the money was there. So you're talking
– I find it laughable that Tyrod Taylor can't make more than Mike Glennon. Mike Glennon?
Okay, but that's even a worse roster than the Bills. Is that not?
But Gary – is five
talking,
is four talking, is again, 10 again, 20 ahead. Million extra dollars guaranteed? Is that worth playing behind
you're
a worse throwing, roster?
Once again, you and your unicorn Jets philosophies were
unicorn Jets philosophies.
Yeah,
you're playing pretend,
you're playing fantasy. You don't know that for a fact. You're saying 20 million guaranteed more a year. You don't know that.
Look at some of
the funny thing was
Jay
Kyle,
Cutler got $60 million guaranteed a couple years ago.
You cut me off. Thank you. The funny thing was the Jets were been linked with Tyrod.
The Browns were
linked with Tyrod. The Bears were never linked with Tyrod in the offseason.
That's the funny thing. They've always
didn't bring up the Bears.
But I'm telling you that you're talking about Glennon's contract. They were always linked to Mike Glennon. They never linked to Tyrod if he was available.
Who? I never brought up the Bears, so I don't know.
I'm telling you, I'm not saying that. You're not listening to me.
But what does this have to do with anything, though? I don't understand.
Kyle, the two teams that I'm saying that have only been linked to was the Jets and the Browns, and they got worse rosters. And you don't know what the money was on.
That's the two.
The only team they offered significant money was to Mike Glennon was the Chicago Bears, and it was a foolish contract. But his name was never linked with Tyrod Taylor to the Chicago Bears.
You know what's funny about all this is a couple weeks ago when you were talking about – and by the way, Mr. Fantasy Boy, you said that you thought Tyrod would be traded to the Browns. You thought a couple weeks ago that
– I was asked
Tyrod Taylor hit the open market. You thought he would
– fall. I was asked to give a prediction.
Thought he would get a boatload of money from the Browns because they had all that cap to spend.
I did say that. But it was never a guaranteed.
So just because he took a pay cut, all of a sudden you think that that's not realistic now?
I'm saying, yeah, probably it wasn't there. Sorry to burst your bubble. Sorry to trump you on that.
Well,
I don't think it was there. I don't think so. His agent poked around, Kyle. They're not fools.
I wonder if this situation was my team, what your thoughts would be on this. I think you're getting a little too fanboy on this one.
I think that
you want to defend Tyrod because
you are the saltiest guy on Twitter. You keep retweeting about it. You keep answering questions. The best thing to do, Kyle, is like I do, is ignore the situation. But you can keep rambling on about it. You're so salty. I got to tell you, man. You're like a bad bowl of soup, man. You're almost uneatable.
No. You're just
yes, you're salty, Kyle. You thought you.
Hey, listen,
you had this fantasy in your head. You had this fantasy in your head that he was going to go to the Jets, the 39th pick.
Oh, no, I didn't. I didn't. Oh,
think, yeah, listen, you put that on Twitter,
audience. Listen,
Joe made fun of you. Drew made fun of it.
Do me a favor, audience. Go through my timeline and see how much I criticize the Jets, and then go through Gary's timeline and see how much he praises the Bills, and then you tell me who's the big fanboy of each team and who's the apologist for each team.
What are you talking about? I don't even start with that BS because you're the one who's on Twitter constantly. I wonder how you keep your job. You see, when these people tweet me like Kyle Fahey, 9 times out of 10, I don't even respond to them because it's a waste of my time.
80% of your Bills tweets are positive. Let's be honest.
They signed Micah Hyde. Very positive. But I can go through my timeline.
Great move, though.
I mostly my posts, Kyle, are retweets, if you want to know.
Okay, fair enough. But still, right, sometimes you can retweet a positive thing, though, versus a negative thing.
One beat reporter that posts anything positive about the Bills.
Doesn't even have to be a beat reporter. It could be a national guy.
That's mostly what I repost.
Could be a national guy. Anyway, let's get Fahey on. Fahey, what's up, man?
Hey, guys. How's it going?
Fahey, your voice. Yeah,
I'm not feeling too great today. Okay. I actually just woke up.
I thought it was that moment in every young man's life.
Not. I'm still waiting. Thanks, genetics.
It's going to happen soon.
Yeah, it's just been a heck of a day. I just woke up like 15 minutes ago. So, if there's been any signings, I'm not aware.
So, Kelvin Beachum, let's talk.
Yeah. I guess he's a good placeholder until we find the legitimate franchise left tackle. Nothing too bad to say about him. I will say that Blake Bortles makes any offensive lineman look bad. And we saw what he did with the Steelers with a quarterback who has a relatively moderate release time compared to Blake Bortles, who just holds that thing like it's his firstborn. So I'm not mad.
All right. Well, yeah, I agree with that. I think that he had a terrible year last year with the Jaguars, but he had excellent season with the Pittsburgh Steelers. I don't like the fact that he's a 6'3" left tackle. That is very short for that position.
Like I said, he's a placeholder until we can find the real guy. Unfortunately, I don't think there's one of those in this draft that can come in and start right away. There are a couple guys who I think you could work into a good left tackle. But look on to next year, I guess.
Absolutely. So who are some of the names that you would like to see the Jets go after? I mean, there's not – obviously,
Hightower's still on the market, and he's been linked to your team. We talked extensively about him. And I would tell you this, I would much rather see him go to the Jets than the New England Patriots. But what number would you be comfortable giving that guy? I mean, that's a middle linebacker. Luke Kuechly's the highest paid. He gets $12 million annually. What would you like to see him, your team give Dante Hightower if that's a possibility?
I would say $10 million a year at the most. Kyle and I discussed this in detail when the first reports came out. Dante Hightower is really good at a couple things, but also not good at a couple of things. And I don't think he's the right guy for the Jets. I'd rather go after a guy like Zach Brown, hailing from Buffalo for a cheaper price. Maybe pick up Kevin Minter too. Combine those two for the same price as Hightower, and I think Zach Brown offers more to the team at this point. I understand the leadership role and aspect of Dante Hightower, but just for what is reported we're throwing at him, I don't think it's worth it. Because when it comes to like pass coverage, here's David Harris and here's Dante Hightower. I mean, it's not that great of an upgrade there, but in the pass rush, and I guess in the middle of the field, it's an upgrade. But still not worth the money in my mind.
Yeah, I'd have to agree. I think Zach Brown and Kevin Minter are both waiting for Hightower to be signed before.
Yeah. They're trying to get a figure.
Yeah, they want to see what the market's going to play out. So I don't think those two guys will get signed until Hightower cashes in first. Give me some other names. We already mentioned Hightower, but some of the names you'd like to see the Jets go after. Obviously, Mike McCann has set the tone already that we're not going to be big spenders. We're getting rid of a lot of all these aging veterans. So tell me some names that you've been looking after. We're at the almost at the bottom of the barrel, or
Right now, number one name that makes sense for the Jets is Chase Daniel. I think we talked about it a little bit about a month ago. I talked about the guys who we interviewed for our offensive coordinator position, how they were all connected to Chase Daniel, and there are still connections to Chase Daniel now with our current offensive coordinator and quarterback coach. So a free agent quarterback, relatively cheap, veteran guy who you can bring in, maybe teach the young guys a couple things, be the Band-Aid for maybe a year or two, not going to lose you games, but certainly not going to win you games. I guess that would just be the one that makes sense. The one, it's hard to pick because right now the cornerback market's extremely barren. Probably the best out there is Brandon Carr, and I think he's 30 or he's 29. I think he's
definitely up there.
Yeah, so he's on the latter end of his career, and I don't want a guy like that, getting big money from me in a year where I'd rather just sign a bunch of guys who we think we can develop into a better player.
Fortunately, this year's draft is pretty stacked with corners. So
yeah, I mean there are about 10 corners who can probably go in the first round. They have first round talent, so that bodes well for the Jets. If they trade back, maybe pick up another second round pick. You could definitely look to use one of those on a guy like Garon Conley from Ohio State, Tre'Davious White from LSU, who I'm not the biggest fan of, but he definitely has some upside, and just other names like that who I'd rather get.
Yeah. All right, come on. I know you've been thinking, man. I see that whiteboard is completely erased.
Yeah.
So.
Right now, it's just kind of like an agenda thing for draft dump. Got to get some articles up there right now.
All right.
Can't forget about them.
Now, I'm going to get off this subject soon. A couple weeks ago, Tyrod Taylor was on your whiteboard.
Yeah.
The news came out. I know you're a little heartbroken, just like my brother over there.
I think Kyle's absolutely right. That agent's a complete idiot. Don't know who represents him, but I would like.
Once again, we're speculating, but we don't. I tell you right now, Kyle, knowing a few pro players, these agents poke around well before they even become unrestricted. They have a clear indication what the market's going to give them.
All right. So what was the exact Tyrod restructure? What is he going to make a year now?
I mean, he's going to be, I believe, the 19th highest paid quarterback, which is very low. I mean, he's getting like 50.
Come on, dude made the Pro Bowl 2 years ago.
I get it, but listen. you don't know. And like I said, he did want to be in Buffalo.
Yeah, I mean, I don't disagree with you there. He may have just not wanted to move.
Maybe and I also believe that there's a lot of teams want to see what's going on with Tony Romo first before Tyrod Taylor. I really do believe that.
I'll tell you this. I think Tyrod could have got more guaranteed money and more money per year someplace else. I don't think it's Chicago. I think you're right about that. I don't think they were ever interested in him. I'll tell you what. The Jets were definitely going to throw a lot of money at him.
But were the Jets going to throw a lot of money? Because if they're in full rebuild mode and Tyrod Taylor might not be, the jury's still out on Tyrod.
I don't think so. I don't think it is. He's shown consistency with me with bad receivers around them, not because of your roster, primarily because of injuries, that he can make it work.
Let's be fair. Tyrod has a huge deficiency. He doesn't target the middle of the field much. Name me how many 300-yard games Tyrod Taylor's had.
Maybe how many winning seasons you guys have had. I mean, he's not working with a lot.
Listen, doesn't matter. I mean, Ryan Tannehill, before he was winning in Miami, he had a bunch of 300-yard games. Jay Cutler has a bunch of 300-yard games. He's not a guy who slings the rock. And unfortunately, at that position,
I'm not asking him to sling the rock 24/7. Well,
yes, in this league, you got to be able to do that. And I love Tyrod Taylor, but
listen. He can definitely throw the ball if he needs to. It's just necessarily he hasn't been asked to.
Well, yes, he definitely has, and there's definitely some inaccuracies about him. Oh, listen, you're talking to a guy who's a Bills fan who followed him closely, who likes him. I like him. You're not coming from a guy who hates him. You're talking to a Bills fan who genuinely likes Tyrod Taylor, and I'm flat out telling you, he's not a complete product. Maybe that's hard. I mean, I know Jets fans are used to bad quarterbacks. He might look golden in your eyes, but I'm telling you, if you look at his skill set and a guy like who has a similar skill set but who is like an upgrade, like a Cam Newton who could run, who has a strong arm, who could air the ball out, that's the type of guy that you want Tyrod to be, but he's just not there yet.
Well, he's not even close in size to Cam Newton. I don't think that's a feasible comparison.
No, he's a mobile quarterback who can air the ball out. That's your probably model guy. I'm not saying he's a truck people over. He could run, but Tyrod could run around him.
Well, what I'll say about Tyrod with, like, the 15 games that he had, Sammy Watkins and Robert Woods and basically the full cast around them, had, like, 22 touchdowns, 6 interceptions, and the completion
percentage. There's no doubt about it. He's got a great stat line. Once again, I love Tyrod. I'm going to keep saying this. I'm glad he's on the board. I was ecstatic, one, because I'm a huge Tyrod Taylor fan. I bought his jersey. I hope that guy is our quarterback for the next 5 years. And I hope he progresses. Two, I knew my brother was going to be super salty and super hurt, so I'm glad that all his dumb tweets that I get to shove that in his face and your face too. Three, it's just that that's probably our best option at quarterback. This year's draft is not a good draft as far as quarterbacks go.
Nope.
So what else is out there? That's why I'm glad that Tyrod Taylor is still built. But if you ever tell me, hey, I'm going to give you Tyrod or I'm going to give you – I don't know, or maybe Phillip Rivers. That's a question for me. Mm. Phillip is an old quarterback too, but it's a question. Yeah. Like Bills fans might be enticed to, hey, let's go over. I could tell you a lot of Bills fans were on the Tony Romo boat. Hey, let's try to get him, and I thought that was complete foolishness.
Yeah, it is. What you guys don't understand is, well, you understand it, but most Bills fans, I don't know, they're lost in the sauce, but. You guys aren't in win now mode. You're not even close to it. So signing a guy like Tony Romo or acquiring Phillip Rivers just makes absolutely no sense when you have a guy like Tyrod Taylor who showed consistently not only that he can stay healthy, unlike Phillip Rivers and Tony Romo, but he's also fairly
young. Rivers is never hurt.
Yeah.
He's always dinged up with something.
Well, here,
he don't miss games.
But you never know.
He played the AFC Championship game with a torn ACL. Please, stop it.
They lost, but
he played though, right? And he gave them a much better chance at competing in that game than the backup. Come on, Fahey, that was a bad point.
All right. Well, anyway,
I don't know. It's Buffalo. It's completely different from I almost said LA, San Diego.
Well,
just different weather, harder hits, colder ground. I mean,
all right. So Fahey, we talked about Chase Daniel, not Chase Daniels.
We talked about Chase Daniels, a name that you like to see the Jets go after.
Why, though? I don't understand that, Faye. He was terrible in that preseason game when we played them in week four.
We're terrible, Kyle. I just need a guy to get me through the next 2 years until we draft somebody who's the future.
He's small, doesn't have a good arm. I don't even think his decision-making's all that good. I guess he's got familiarity with the QB coach.
Is Garrett Grayson still on the market?
No, he actually has a nice backup spot right behind Drew Brees and Luke McCown.
That's not a backup. That's a third string.
All right. Well,
is he a backup? At least to somebody.
He's a backup, Kyle. He is a backup to the backup, Kyle.
And you know what? I'm a backup too. I'm like maybe like 98th in line for the Jets QB.
All right.
But hey, I'm a backup.
I don't know if it's that far back.
I'm trying to ask Fahey. Give me some other targets the Jets to go out. You said Zach Brown. You'd like to see him. I think everyone and their mom wants Zach Brown or Kevin Minter. But like I said, that's not going to happen until Mr. Hightower gets signed, because we got to let to see how the market plays out. A cornerback, you mentioned Brandon Carr. He's up there in age. Give me some other names, because the Jets have a lot of holes to fill.
Yeah, I think we're going to go draft heavy this year, or we go to filling these needs. I mean, honestly, I can't think of another free agent besides those two linebackers that I would want to sign, unless there's somebody that would completely...
You mentioned, though, this is interesting, and I meant to kind of dig at that point. You said instead of signing Hightower, you would rather take that money and sign both Zach Brown and Nick. What happened to your pick last year, Darren Lee? I mean,
I think Kevin Minter would be behind him.
Oh, so you would move Minter behind Lee? I would guarantee you Minter would not sign up for that.
He's familiar with the system. Hey, if he can beat Deron Lee in camp, good for him. I'll let Deron Lee sit for another year, basically, get some more experience. Because, you know, there's also David Harris in the mix. So it would be a pretty strong linebacking core. I'm not going to lie. I like the idea of Zach Brown, Kevin Minter, Deron Lee, then a veteran guy like David Harris. Not to say that Kevin Minter and Zach Brown aren't veterans, but they're still relatively young in age. That would be a pretty good linebacking core. You know, obviously – the other guys on the linebacking court, let's hope that Kevin Green works some magic there. But, yeah, if Kevin Minter just straight up beat him out in camp, like it wasn't close, I'd probably put Deron Lee behind him. Because, you know, I still don't know if Deron Lee's an inside linebacker. You know, with his skill set, you could move him to the outside if you wanted to. I mean, the it's still out on him right now.
All right. Now, a name that's been linked to the Jets is Travis Cadet, the running back. He's primarily a special team. Well, you know, I mean, it was – Kyle and I are really happy with the Bills and what the Jets are doing this offseason, because they're not –
nothing.
But you want a year where you kind of hit the refresh button and try to go after quality draft picks. You don't want to keep – the winning franchises – with the exception of the New England Patriots, they really build with their talent through the draft. Green Bay, Pittsburgh, Baltimore.
Yeah.
But, you know, to me, it's like you go out and you make these moves and they wind up hurting you. The Jets, you know, look at 2 years ago, their roster, you know, half those guys are no longer even with the Jets.
Or in the NFL.
Well, either way, it's just like, hey, you know what? It's time to hit the reset button. I like bargain basement guys. Guys like Zach Brown, who the Bills signed at the veteran minimum last year.
And for some reason.
Well, he was out. No team knocked on his door. He actually – his agent called the Bills, said, my guy wants to play for you. And the Bills said, fine, we'll offer him this. But that's what I'm saying. Those deals are out there. Lorenzo Alexander, those players are out there.
Yeah, I don't get that signing for you guys. The dude's like 35. I would have just let him walk. I know he's a great special teamer, and he had a decent amount of sacks.
Well, he's 33, and I got to tell you, he's not your typical 33-year-old. You look like guys like James Harrison. Those are workout warriors. Those are guys that are constantly working out. That's who Lorenzo Alexander is. And if you got to do yourself a favor, go on YouTube tonight and – type in Lorenzo Alexander at the Pro Bowl. Seemed like the only guy that was on the field playing.
I was there. I saw him get a couple tackles.
Well, he won the MVP of that game.
Well, that's because he got the tipped interception at the end to basically seal the game for the AFC.
Oh, he led in the most tackles. You know that already, right?
Yeah, but I guarantee he would have won without that interception.
Either way, you're getting a player that's hustling and you're not paying a whole lot of money for him. And it's a 2-year deal, so you cut your losses after 2 years. So it's not a bad signing. I'm not upset with it. He's a great leader. He's a great special teams player. The guy, he got 12.5 sacks for you. And they plan on using him as a Sam linebacker, which is a guy that's going to be up on the line of scrimmage. I'm not mad at that move at all. I think it's a good move. And I don't think Kyle will disagree with that at all.
No, not at all. Actually, you know, when we were talking, probably maybe back like in December, we were like both.
Yeah, you wanted him on the Jets.
Well, I didn't say as much. I said, like, I don't really know. I haven't really looked into who's going to be a free agent yet. I said, I know one guy who is, because I really don't watch too many non-AFC East games. I pretty much watch none. I knew Lorenzo was going to be, and he slowed down a little bit towards the end of the season, but when I looked at what the Jets needed, because free agency is a need-based approach, and he was a guy who was winning off the edge consistently. And he also gave you special teams value. And what the Jets needed was they needed an edge guy who could win every now and then. And they needed a leadership, obviously. And they needed special teams. And he gives you all that. I mean, this dude is a freak on kickoffs, man. With his age, he runs down and he just hammers people.
Yeah.
So when I looked at his age, I thought the Jets could probably get him on a decent bargain offer, which is exactly what the Bills did. So I'm not upset at that at all if I'm a Bills fan.
Yeah, so I'm not mad with that move at all. I 2 years, he's not a spring chicken, but the guy works out, and you never have to wonder about his work ethic. And those are the type of players you want, like I said.
Yeah, we want that on the Jets.
I guarantee people when James Harrison was signed at 37 years of age to the Pittsburgh Steelers, no Pittsburgh Steelers fan was going like, what are they doing? He's 37 years old. They know that type of the work ethic he has. And Kyle, I don't know, Lorenzo Alexander has a picture on his Twitter. He's on some new diet. I don't know if you could see it, but he's
hopefully not the Todd Bowles diet.
I did see that.
And like I said, this is a guy that used to weigh 315 pounds. He played guard at one point.
Not in the NFL, right?
Yeah. Just
like a guard in the NFL.
He played guard in the NFL.
Lorenzo Alexander.
He got the nickname one man gang because he played guard, tight end, defensive tackle, linebacker, and fullback, all in the NFL.
It's a really interesting story. I'm trying to pull that up right now. I don't know how. It seems like he tweets a decent amount. He's actually got more tweets than me, Gary. I don't know how he keeps his job being on Twitter all the time.
Yeah.
Well, he has an off season, Kyle. Then again, you have an off season.
Yeah. So.
I also did have a day off of school today because it's snow.
Oh, yeah.
Ah.
There you go.
There you go. I mean, this all is right. You don't have to question that this guy's working out.
He's a cool dude. To be honest, like I saw he was tweeting with our Rock Pile Report buddies. And I think it was Drew who expressed concern over giving him a big contract in his age. And Lorenzo basically straight up, and you ever hear him speak? He's really well-spoken, loves doing appearances on the John Murphy show. He said, listen, it's only going to be a couple years. I ain't going to have money tied up to you long-term. And like, this is before he signed a contract. I mean, I thought that was kind of like, you know, like, I don't know how his agent felt about that, but.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? Like I said, I'd be concerned if he had a terrible work ethic, but he doesn't. This guy, you never have to worry about this guy. He's a guy he's a constant pro. He's in the building 6 o'clock in the morning working out. That's the type of guy you want on your roster. I don't care what age he's at.
Yeah.
Funny thing about a Rock Pile Report, I was actually in Spanish class 2 days ago. And we had like 3 minutes left, so we were just on our phones. And my friend, who's a big Bills fan, he followed Bills Fanatics and Rock Pile Report on Twitter. And I saw it. I go, hey, I know a couple guys from there. And I told him all about him. And it was just funny.
Wow. It's interesting how the world works, how people know one another. Yeah, I guess he went to the combine, Gary, as a D tackle.
Yeah.
Wow.
He's played everything now.
I mean, his
that's combine a terrible 40.
6'2", 289, 5'1", 2. You watch him play now.
He's much faster than that.
He's running faster than 5'2". I'll tell you that much.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's not 290 pounds anymore. Either.
Yeah. What is he now? Like
He's listed at 244. So.
Oh, well, fairly close.
All right, Fahy, before we let you go, because we got a lot of free agency just stuff to talk about, I didn't really know this until you told me the other day on the phone. But in addition to your podcast, you're also doing some writing about the draft on your own website. So tell us a little bit about that. What's the website so I can pull it up on the screen?
Draftumblog.wordpress.com. Terrible domain, but if I get big, I'll start paying for it. I'm not going to make an investment quite yet. But yeah, I write about the draft. I also got Alex Rufio 187 on Twitter. I don't know if you guys are familiar with him.
Yeah, it's Rufio underscore 187. Come on, man. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
You apologize to Alex, not me.
Yeah, so we've just been putting in work. These are all of his articles right now. He's doing all the player profiles. He's doing a really good job on those. Right now, I'm kind of just running the thing. I do have a mock draft coming out this week, mock draft 2.0. So that'll be interesting. And all the pre-combine rankings are mine. So just follow us on Twitter, at official draft. Oh, can't see that. Hold up. At official draft. Yeah. Shouting us. I already had that prepared. No, we just hope to get a lot of stuff on there before the draft and hope it works out.
All right. Cool. Well, really cool. And thank you for coming on. Slow show tonight. So in terms of guests coming on, so definitely appreciate you.
Always welcome, Faye.
Yeah. Kyle, I see the new hair. You trying to keep up with Gary?
Oh, jeez. One day, I guess this is what I get for making fun of your hair.
Yeah, I came back with this one.
All right, I'll see you.
All right.
All right, so let's talk more about the Dolphins. I want to save Kenny Stills for when Joe comes on. He did tell me he's coming on, so I'll take that L, I guess, when he comes on. So maintaining in-house guys, we'll talk more about Stills. Andre Branch, Gary, didn't like this signing, Gary. He got paid more than Jabal Sheard. You've been a Jabal Sheard fan for a while now. You said the Patriots got a steal when they signed him a couple years back. Jabal Sheard actually hit the open market. Branch didn't. And I guess that Sheard didn't get the market that he was expecting. Branch got a better deal than him. His money basically equates to $2 million a sack. And Gary, not all sacks are created equal, because Cam Wake is the guy who's commanding the double teams. He's the guy who's commanding the chip blocks from tight ends and running backs. Andre Branch was never getting that, yet Cam Wake was extremely more productive than Andre Branch.
Yeah, he gets a lot of cleanup sacks. Like, it's – don't get me wrong. I like Branch coming out of Clemson. I thought that he was going to be a lot better than what he is today in the NFL. But we see this all the time. Pass rushers get overpaid. Jabal Sheard was very shocking, Kyle. I thought his market was going to be tremendous. It's been a really quiet market as far as defensive ends go. I mean, Dayton Jones just got picked up, but you know, I thought he was going to get scooped up right away. Even Chris Long, I think he, even at 32 years of age, I thought that he had constantly good pressure off the edge. His sack numbers are down, but I thought his market would be a little bit better, especially being off of a Super Bowl team. They're just not seeing pass rushers get paid this year like they were in years past. But Branch cashed in with his team. I think that he got away with highway robbery in this deal.
Yeah, 16.8 fully guaranteed at signing. Now, the Dolphins did give some more money to Cameron Wake again. But as far as my understanding goes, Branch is still getting more money than him, which is crazy. I know Cameron Wake is 35 now, or going to be 35 by the time the season starts.
They're paying for what's called blue sky, Kyle. So they're banking on the fact that Branch will make that next leap forward and he will be the guy, and maybe Wake will take the back seat. I don't know if that's going to happen. Cameron Wake is an absolute animal, though.
Yeah, let's see. 1 year, the Dolphins, February 20th, 2017. He received a $1 million signing bonus. It's basically he just got $9.1 million in additional money. He's already 35 right now. And Branch is averaging, what, $8 million a year?
And obviously that $17 million fully, it's not just injury guarantees, full guarantees, a big number for a guy who's had branches production. And it's not just about the stats. It's also what do they do? And that's why you need to watch the film to really get a good idea of what a player is bringing to the team. And this has always been the case with Cam Wake. Same thing with Olivier Vernon last year.
Here's a point, and I'm just playing devil's advocate, because Cameron Wake has shown to be a liability in the run game. We said this years out. You know, he's played more of a limited role. We've seen guys his age. Dwight Freeney is only on passing downs. You know, Andre Branch, on the other hand, has stayed on the field. I like to see what their snap count is total for the year. That would be an interesting factor, because either way, I don't justify, because, like I said, I think Cameron Wake is just a more productive player overall. But I guarantee that Andre Branch is on the field more often than Cameron Wake is.
I guess going forward, yeah, that, I mean, the money should indicate that you're paying what you're paying for what you're playing for, I guess. But I mean, Branch is not even good in the run game. And you know what's interesting is,
no, he's not, but he's not. Keep in mind, Kyle, he dethroned James Jones, or Jason Jones rather, for that starting role.
And basically took away a lot of Mario Williams playing time.
And Mario Williams playing time too. Those two guys were basically X'd out of it. So really he had a ladder climb. He was almost an afterthought for the Miami Dolphins. But he earned that spot, and I guarantee you that his snap count's going to be tremendously higher than Cameron Wake's is going forward.
I mean, the plan for Wake last season was to make him, you know, just a pass rush specialist. And when they weren't getting the production from Williams that they had wanted, when they weren't getting the production from Jason Jones and other guys that they had wanted, he assumed a bigger role. I mean, he was just too damn good to keep off the field. You wonder if that's going to be the plan going forward, you know. Will they look to address edge in the draft? You know, there's a decent amount of edge guys in this draft. We had Kevin of the Finalysis on, said that, you know, Miami could still use a really long, lanky pass rusher to really work in the wide nine. You know, maybe they'll get a guy like that to work in on early downs, put Cameron Wake on third down, keep him fresh. But the thing is with Branch, though, he's not as good in the run game as advertised. And a lot of beat reporters were saying run-stopping specialist Andre Branch. But a lot of those guys had walked back from those comments and realizing that's you know, he's actually really not that good at it. And I got to be honest, though, like, you know, watching all the coaches film of the Dolphins games, I can't really say that he's really jumped off on film to me. And we're looking at his contract value. It's his sixth highest. This is according to overthecap.com. Sixth highest of 403 defensive end contracts. So it's definitely a big deal. And this is Cam Wake, sixth highest. Andre Branch, what is his? So he is – Andre Branch is eighth highest. So right around the same thing. I guess it's factoring in what their number is for this given year. I don't know how they really measure that. But anyway, let's
– two top ten as far as pay scale goes, defensive ends.
They definitely invested money on their defensive line for sure. Even Mario Williams last year, that was no small contract that they gave him. They signed him in the first couple of days of free agency.
$8.5 million.
Yep. So, Gary, I think you said good move by the used car salesman for the trade that they had made for the player from the Rams. I'm forgetting his name. Is it Hayes?
Yeah. And you know what, Kyle? This is the spot where William Haynes wanted to go. If you watched the Hard Knocks season, the LA Rams season, Mr. William Haynes, he's a big firm believer in mermaids. So he doesn't believe in dinosaurs. So he wanted to be close by the ocean, and this was definitely the spot he wanted to land in. And this is a good trade. He's an older guy, but he's got a good burst off the edge. He plays with some power. I think they're going to – I know Travis wants another edge guy, but I think that they're going to be done as far as maybe in the draft in the later rounds. But you're looking at their top three edge guys right there in Wake. And I guarantee you that William Haynes will be on running downs for Cameron Wake.
And I hear that that's actually his specialty, is not the pass rush. I mean,
he has a great burst off the edge. I, I,
I challenge anyone to put film of him on, and you know, you look at his 40 number. Obviously, he's older in age, I don't think, but it was a 4.59 when he came into the draft.
Yeah, in comparison's sake, we're saying Myles Garrett's a freak. He ran a 4.64. So 4.59 for a guy 272 pounds, which is right around Myles Garrett's size. That's a big boy. And I don't know if that was his weight at the combine. I'm trying to pull up his combine numbers, but having a little trouble pulling that up right now. But I don't know too much about this player, but you're saying it's a good signing. And other people that I respect said good thing as well.
It's a good trade, no doubt about it. It's a good trade. And, you know, like I said, he's up there in age, but he's still got a year or two. And we always see this with defensive linemen, edge guys. I mean, look at Dwight Freeney. Kyle. How old is Dwight Freeney, 37?
37, 38.
Oh, James Harrison's about to be 40. You know, some of these guys keep in good shape. Cameron Wake, 35, going to be 36 by the start of the season. We mentioned Lorenzo Alexander. So these guys could still be productive. Julius Peppers. We forgot Julius Peppers, Kyle. Just got a contract with the Carolina Panthers. Yeah. Edge guys could be productive in their mid to late 30s. They can be.
Especially if you keep their snap count down.
Right.
Let's bring our buddy on, Joe Blewett, our Jets contributor, Jet Nation Radio. What's going on, Joe?
What's up? What's up, guys? Kyle, you having a bad day with that? What's going on there?
I guess only the cool people wear hats.
Well, I think Joe's hiding something too. I think Joe has a crew cut. What are we talking about? He doesn't even need to hide his hair.
Yeah, I don't need to hide anything. But if I turn my computer to the left, you'll see outside, which I don't know if you heard, we got some snow around New Jersey. So it's quite cold in my basement right now. So that's why I'm wearing a hat. But
okay.
And that snow is the reason why my hair is not done, because I didn't have to go anywhere today other than shovel snow. So.
Anyway. So you were bumming it.
Kind of, yeah, a little bit.
Oh, and so can I play an audio file for you guys? Is that okay?
If it plays loud, I doubt it will, but go ahead.
Let's see if it plays into my mic. I hope it does.
$8 million a year, that's probably where I would fall. For a receiver like Kenny Stills. I don't know exactly years. I don't think that's absurd. I'm still sticking to you get signed for right around $8-9 million a year. It's not happening. I'm telling you, it's not happening. You're not getting Kenny Stills for $8 million a year. We will see, Kyle.
Answers? Can you? Kyle, what's happened with that?
Listen, I'll take the L. I'll admit it. I'll take the L.
Kyle's hearing it from all fronts this episode, and as he should, by the way, because.
But the caveat is he could have gotten more, but he didn't. He chose, listen, tax-free state, familiarity with Gase. Obviously, he's never really been productive before playing with Gase.
Familiarity is a factor in the reason why he stayed?
Yeah, it is.
Oh, okay.
Just making sure.
But listen, you want to talk about familiarity with Tyrod. He's also under a new coaching staff. So I don't even know that argument is valid.
Joe,
you missed a
building training staff. I mean, there's many factors, but go ahead.
Oh yeah, that training staff, that medical staff, they're excellent.
Hey, listen, for some reason I hate that training staff with a passion, Kyle. You're talking about, I'm not critical of the Bills. I swear to God, I would go down that building right there and hit that old man in his hip tomorrow to make sure he's off the team next year. I do not want that training staff anywhere near any of my players. But then let's talk about Kenny Stills.
Yeah, Kenny Stills. So reports that Philadelphia was also in the running for him, and there was one other team that really made a strong push for him too. It's probably really good for his career that he didn't go to Philadelphia, because Carson Wentz is a terrible downfield thrower. He chose to stick with Gase and Tannehill. Tannehill's deep balls really kind of excelled over previous years. And the guaranteed figures, I think $19 million a year. And one thing is for sure is the receiver market's kind of like stagnated. It's not really excelled at the rate that we're going to see it at. I thought he should have gotten more. The reports were saying that he should have gotten more. The valuable player, but listen, you guys were right. $8 million fell in right there. And the good thing about Kenny Stills, it's a 4-year deal. It's not a 5-6 year deal. So by the time he hits free agency again, he's going to be 28 years old. So he's still in line for potentially another big payday.
Yeah. I just remember texting you, and the first thing I got, I actually screenshot and sent it to Gary. It was like, well, the state tax.
Kyle always.
I think he's muted.
I didn't mute him.
I think he might have muted himself.
I'm back in action.
Go ahead, Gary. You got this.
Yeah, Kyle had to take it on the chin on that one. No doubt about it.
Yeah. I think in that episode I said 16 to 18 guaranteed too. I didn't even see the guaranteed, but you just said it was $18 or $18 million, Kyle.
It was 19.
19. Okay. Yeah, it's what I expected. You should just listen to me more often, I guess. So Gary, I still gotta go back and I gotta hear your guys' argument about Tyrod. I know what happened. Like I said, you know, me.
Let's not revisit that again.
But let me tell you something, Joe. You were a big guy stomping for Tyrod Taylor and your fantasy world. Guess what? He didn't even leave the Buffalo Bills. He didn't even leave.
Joe, would you agree that he's a damn fool?
Yeah. Oh. We talked about it yesterday, Kyle. Oh,
He didn't want to go to those ugly Jets uniforms, or he didn't want to go to the Cleveland Browns.
No, but he turned down like another $6-7-8 million a year.
Let me take a pay cut to stay with the team that hasn't made the playoffs in 17 years.
Show me one article. Both of you guys, show me one article where he was.
Gary, more money. Gary, I'm no Manish Mehta or Jason Cole, or any of those guys. But if a guy in Mike Glennon is getting more money through 2 years than you, I know you can get more money when you're
okay.
This
is the point I made to my brother Kyle, and he was like, "I wasn't talking about the Bears." There was no article that linked Tyrod Taylor to the Bears at all. Okay, but in the offseason, there was a bunch of articles that linked Mike Glennon to the Bears. So we don't even know if the Bears had interest in Tyrod Taylor.
They're the only foolish.
Can you not interrupt me, Kyle? They're the only foolish team that paid Mike Glennon, okay, for that amount. Yeah, he was linked to the Jets. He was linked to the Browns. But guess what? We don't know what the Jets or the Browns were willing to pay Tyrod. It's all speculation. I don't want to hear it. Listen, the Chicago Bears are a damn fool for paying that Napoleon Dynamite stunt double. They should have no business paying him that much money, but there's a fool born every day. I don't think the Jets or the Browns were that high on Tyrod Taylor. You don't know that for a fact.
Well, the reports
you don't know that for a fact.
The fact is we haven't seen any numbers, because we don't need to know these numbers though. And sometimes contracts that aren't actually signed, you never always get those details, but the Browns are loaded in cap and they're known to have
significant. You have no idea.
Listen, you told me not to cut you off. So practice what you preach, brother. So, hold up. Listen a moment. The Browns, $100-something million in cap space, significant interest in Tyrod, please. All right, let's get away from
that. They had the opportunity to trade for him, too, if they were that. They could have skipped all of that and just made him the Bills a sweet offer. They had plenty of draft capital. If they want him that bad, they were worried about the Jets, or they worried about the Chicago Bears, who had no links to him, they could have made the Bills a pretty sweet offer.
We don't know what the Bills were asking for in terms of a trade.
We don't even know if the Bills were willing to trade him. That's what it's all speculative. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
Let's keep playing fantasy and unicorns. But the bottom line is he never left the Bills. Salty fan number one, salty fan number two on the phone.
Gary, Kyle, you listen to my show almost every week.
At least we sweep the Bills last year.
Did I spend any more than 20 minutes talking about Tyrod on my show? Probably not.
It was the one time I came on. And we spent a decent amount of time, but that was about it, though.
It figures because this guy is the saltiest guy that Tyrod did not leave.
But I think
bigger deal than it really is.
I think you know.
The funny thing was, this was a dead subject, Joe. And Kyle goes like today, he goes on a rant again. He keeps going on these random rants about Tyrod Taylor.
I think you know if he got to the open market, he was getting a lot more than that.
I don't think
Gary's being the ultimate fanboy right now.
Joe, this is the bottom line. Teams poke around. Players get and their agents poke around before they hit the open market. They do it at the combine, especially. You hear rumors all the time. If Tyrod Taylor thinks he was going to get that much more money, and it had to be a significant amount. I'm not saying that maybe $1 million would not entice you more to go to the Jets. I wouldn't go to the Jets for $1 million more. I'm sorry. I mean, either way,
The bottom line is this. Teams were poking around about Tyrod, and it wasn't significant enough. That's the bottom line.
You can't have anything. You listen, teams might do it, might.
They definitely
have. But it's illegal, and Tyrod Taylor's agent has proved to be a fool in the past when he took that contract over the summer, which was a dumb contract.
You know my friend Anthony Fierro, Nick Fierro. Their stepbrother is Eugene Monroe. He told us flat out that they do it well before they're even an unrestricted free agent. And I'm not trying to get Eugene Monroe in trouble, but he's retired anyway right now. But they do it well before that they even hit the open market. So I'm sorry your mind's
blown. There's no formal offers and things. And like I said, it gets into
– But the team has a number in their head. Hey, listen, this is what we're willing to do for you.
And you start low. Why would you, in a non-formal negotiation, would you offer a big boatload of money? You'd start low.
You're not listening.
Okay. All right.
You hear things one way. That's your problem.
Hey, Joe, have you – what do you think about the Miami Dolphins giving Rashad Jones – Rashad Jones had a season-ending injury last year. They gave him a big new deal. He's an in-house guy. He's the guy that they want to maintain. He actually held out for a couple days in practice last year. They gave him a big new deal. I think $30 to $35 million guaranteed. What are your thoughts on that?
For how many years? I didn't even see that.
All right. Well, I'm pulling that up right now. I think it's something like a 5-year deal, $50 to $60 million guaranteed. Big old contract. 29 years of age. This dude, one of the better safeties in the league, no doubt about it. I don't know if they put his new contract in here over the cap.com. Let's see, SpotTrack. I think it's $30 to $35 million guaranteed.
Just pull up an article; they'll have his contract up there.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a lot of money guaranteed for a guy who's 29 years old. So that's like a classic Mike Tannenbaum contract, where the first couple of years, yeah, it's going to work out fine, but then in that third, fourth, fifth year, it'll start to hit you right in the face. The first couple of years will look fine, but that's a lot of money for a safety. I know he's a top safety, but. $12 million a year.
He's a top safety coming off an injury.
Exactly. That's
a shoulder injury, too. And by the way, he's known for his hard hitting, and you need your shoulders to do some hard hitting. So, you don't know how well he'll respond.
Not only that, Kyle, you need your shoulders to bat balls down, too, Kyle.
Yes, but let's be honest, though. It's a little bit more important for tackling, and he's more of a tackler than anything else. He's more of a box safety. He's not, he ain't no free ranger, over-the-top Devin McCourty guy.
He's no Issa Abdul Kadus.
Oh, yeah. Listen, give Issa a break, man. His career might be over.
I know. And you know what? Sad to see that happen. But you know what? There's always I think Duke Williams might be available. So
Aaron Williams is available.
You know what? I would I tell you this right now. Any team that picks up Aaron Williams, shame on you guys. Shame on you guys. Shame on you guys.
Why is it shame on them? Why? If he wants to continue playing, I don't understand.
Listen, Kyle, there was a good safety that came from the Green Bay Packers a couple years ago. I forget. His name slipped in my mind.
Oh, Nick Collins?
Nick Collins. Same thing. He had a neck injury just like – and he was a pro – Aaron Williams never made a Pro Bowl. This guy was a multiple Pro Bowl player.
Yeah. He had a pick six in the Super Bowl.
No team wanted to pick him up after those neck injuries. That's what I'm saying. I wouldn't want – if I was a GM, I wouldn't want that on my hands. I wouldn't want that blood on my hands. I'm sorry. I like Aaron Williams. A good player. When he's healthy, he's one of the better – he's definitely a above-average safety. But I wouldn't want – God forbid, he's one neck injury away from being paralyzed, I believe. Severe neck injury.
What about Timmons? Timmons has been in the league for a long time, 10 years with the Steelers. Lawrence Timmons. Miami signed him to a deal. What do you guys think of that?
His contract, Kyle?
Yeah, I'll pull that up. Joe, yeah. What are your thoughts on Lawrence Timmons? I mean, I know you've watched a lot of his play over the years.
I think he's a good, aggressive player. I'm not sure how he is in the locker room, but it really depends on the deal. That last year you pulled up, I didn't see the Timmons one, but I think that's a massive overpay. I'm not just being a biased Jets fan, but that's a lot of money for a guy like Rashad Jones. He's 30. I don't know. Where is it?
SpotTrack. Yeah, so Timmons, I think he got – it's not outrageous or anything, but it's definitely a nice contract. The perception that I got from Dolphins fans is they were pretty happy with it. Linebacker was their biggest weakness by far. I mean, Kiko Alonso really isn't an inside linebacker. He should probably be playing Will, which I think the plan is to move him over to Will.
He's upset about that. I don't know if you saw recent articles about that. He wants to be a Mike backer.
I didn't, but he's – I mean, Kiko, he's small. He doesn't have the athleticism that he used to have, and he's a player that the only way that he really wins, it's hard for him to get off blocks, is he has to guess. And if he's wrong, it's disaster. Not the case with Timmons. So Timmons, two-year, $12 million contract, $11 million guaranteed. I don't know if it's fully guaranteed or just an injury guarantee, but two years, pretty decent salary. I mean, listen, we're talking Hightower potentially getting $12 million a year. This guy's getting about half that. Now, obviously, he's a younger player, but this, to me, spells a better value. What do you guys think?
Than Dante Hightower?
Yeah.
You know, for 2 years, you're not married to the guy long term. He is 30, which is not – he's been in the league since 2007. Kyle, you mentioned earlier that – he's an old 30. He's been. He has a lot of miles, a lot of playing time underneath his belt.
10 years.
Yeah, so he's not a spring chicken. But then again, you see a lot of linebackers.
They could play Darryl Smith, Carlos Dansby, well into their 30s.
London Fletcher.
London Fletcher. I mean, it's one of those positions. David Harris, another one. I'm not upset with the move. He's a Florida guy. He comes from Florida State. I like it, you know, and they addressed a big need for them.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you want to see what Zach Brown and Kevin Minter get, because I think those are younger guys that are much more athletic than Lawrence Timmons, and they're probably more versatile. I guarantee, Kyle, there's going to be that point where Zach Brown and Kevin Minter, they might wait too long, or the market passes them by. And teams like the Jets, who are linebacker needy, and even the Bills, Kyle, I mean, think about it. They need – I mean, right now they have three starting linebackers, but I'm sure they'd love to have Zach Brown back in the building.
Joe, out of all those linebackers, would you want the Jets to sign any of those guys? And if so, for how much?
Oh, well, with the Timmons thing really quick, I just to show I'm not biased against the Dolphins, I think that's a good signing for a team who's pushing to the playoffs. It's a guy who usually – is, you know, leading the Steelers in tackle. So I thought that's a good move. 30 years old, you can have him for another 3-4 years, whatever it may be. So I thought that's a nice contract for him. In terms of who I would want, I said it with the Hightower thing, and I tagged Gary. I don't think Gary answers on Twitter much. I just think it is what it is.
Don't be offended by that. I'm rarely on it, so.
Yeah, whatever. But for me, you got to start answering. I feel offended. I thought we were friends, Gary.
Yeah, I'll tell you what. Send me a text. You have my phone number, so.
Yeah. Well, we still got to figure out if you're going to Beer Fest, Gary.
I think most likely I am.
Sweet. All right. But, yeah, Hightower. Me and Kyle talked about it a lot. You know, obviously me and Kyle went out to grab a bite to eat yesterday. Averages in around, you know, 74 tackles. A year, a couple sacks. I think Luke Kuechly's at 12.3, if I'm not mistaken, a year. And he wants to be the highest paid inside linebacker. So 12.4 and over for him. I'm not in on that. I would jump out of that. And then for anybody else, I would take Brown. Looking at 149 tackles this year. Gets to the quarterback. If he is willing to come to the Jets for $9, $10 million a year, I would do it for that amount, because I think he's a difference maker at linebacker. And let me get his – I have his stats right here somewhere, where he got stats this year that only Patrick Willis in 2009 and Urlacher in like 2003 got. I just have to find them right here. Hold on. Oh, okay. So he had 149 tackles, 4 sacks, 2 forced fumbles, and an interception. Since 2001, only 2 players in NFL have reached those numbers since Patrick Wilson 2009 and Urlacher in 2002. So, you know, if you can get that guy for $9-10 million, you lose David Harris for $6.5 million. So it makes up for it a lot. You have a new piece to your linebacking core. You know, it's a young core. Then he's 27 years old. You have Maldon, who I'm iffy on than most Jets fans. I like Jordan Jenkins at the strong side outside linebacker spot. So you're really revamping your linebacker core with a signing like that. So Brown would definitely be my preference out of those three guys. But Minter is kind of like a nice consolation prize to me because he has familiarity with Bulls.
Now you know, I'm Kyle and Joe, I'm especially my brother Kyle, I'm all about the bargain basement guys. I like the guys that hold on too long and the market already passed them by.
We saw the Bills were able to capitalize on Zach Brown last year. They got him at the veteran minimum. He got a one-year contract. And Lorenzo Alexander. Now, both those guys are going to cash in this year because they played so well. Now, a guy like Zach Brown.
Hey, Joe, maybe you can lower your volume a little bit. We're hearing a little echo. I think it's coming from you.
Yeah, I'll try. Huh?
Anyway, what I was going to say is maybe a guy like Zach Brown, Dante Hightower gets the $12 million. Zach Brown gets a $9 million deal. What about a guy like Kevin Minter might get a $4 million deal? Would that even be a better value than Zach Brown?
Well, the thing with Minter is I don't think he's going to get $4 million a year.
Well, you know, I'm just saying. Kind of guy.
Yeah, if it was $4 or $5 million a year, definitely, because for a team who's rebuilding, you want to find a bunch of pieces instead of one or two pieces, where the Jets are right around $22 to $24 million this year still remaining. So if you can add him and then add a safety in a corner instead of adding, you know, Zach Brown and another player, if you can fit more role players into that, then yeah, that's fine. But I'm thinking Minter's around $6, $7 million. You know, young guy, I believe he's going to be 25, 80-something tackles last year, pretty productive at Arizona. So
familiar with Ball's system.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think he'll probably be like a $3 to $4 or $5 million difference from Brown. But Brown is a guy, especially if he continues to do what he did with the Bills last year, which you have to hope it's not a flash in the pan type of season. He's a guy you could build a defense around. So I haven't heard any problems with him in the locker room, at least in terms of last year with the Bills. So I wouldn't be worried about him being too big of a voice negatively in the locker room. So either one of those guys, I would really like it. But for a guy like Hightower, averaging around 75 tackles a year, wanting that kind of money with those injuries, I understand he has a pedigree, but you know, he's been with Alabama two championships, the Patriots two championships. How is he going to respond to going to the Jets and inevitably losing, you know, 11, 12 games next year? So I like Brown and Minter better in terms of price tag, definitely.
Yeah, Kyle, I don't know if you're listening to our show. Kyle Fahey wanted both of those guys.
And you just drafted a linebacker in the first round last year. That's smart.
Well, Minter would be the backup, Kyle. You didn't hear that.
Why would you sign a backup for $6, $7 million a year?
We're talking about Fahey here now.
No, let's throw that to Gary, I want to ask you about, I believe his name is Corey White, the safety that Kyle was talking about.
He's a corner.
Corner. What do you think about
– He's actually that guy? Both. I love the guy. I don't know what his market's going to be, because if you're having that corner, you still got to wait for Brandon Carr to be signed. You still got to wait for Altron Werner to be signed, Morris Claiborne to be signed. You still got to wait for Sam Shields to be signed. So there's a lot of guys that are ahead of him. He's going to be the third tier. He's still going to be third tier. Even though he played exceptionally well for the Bills, he's still not above those guys. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, no, just in terms of
And also Nickell Robey-Coleman, I think he might get paid more than he's getting more interest than Corey White.
Yeah,
that's a bargain guy.
That's what I'm talking about. He's listed as a strong safety on NFL.com, so I guess he plays both. But I'm just – for the Jets right now, you know, there's a couple linebackers. I'll really be happy with Minter or Brown. I'm worried about the secondary right now. I want a corner or a free safety at least before we go into the draft. I'm assuming they're going to. It's only the first not even week of free agency. But you look at the corner market. There's Morris Claiborne and a bunch of nobodies. And Morris Claiborne even – I might even be a nobody. You know, I have Altron Werner, who's a cover two Tampa type of guy, zone guy, who I'm, you know, can't fit in with the Jets. So I'm really looking into the deeper guys. And Kyle mentioned White last week on my show. So I was just, you know, wanted your opinion.
Yeah, White is definitely I love him. He plays hard. He tackles well. And you can play him anywhere. He's a guy that when he was with New Orleans, he was the nickel corner. He played safety with the Bills when Aaron Williams was down. He was backing up Stephon Gilmore originally. You know, he's a guy that could do anything. So you wanted those type of guys in your secondary. And he plays well, and he plays with a chip on his shoulder. Small school. He's from Samford, not Stanford. So he definitely – I like the guy a lot. I hope the Bills can retain him. But he's a bigger guy, 6'1", 210. I think that the Bills are more, if they're going to go after a corner, the name you mentioned is going to be Altron Werner, because he is more of that zone scheme that Sean McDermott likes running.
Hey, Joe, let's stick with the Bills. I know you got to leave in like a minute or two, but are you familiar with watching Micah Hyde, Green Bay Packers? I mean, I asked that question because the Packers play a lot of national games that are on.
Yeah, I thought that was a great signing. I was kind of.
Hold on, Joe. Something's wrong with your mic. You're coming in all choppy.
Okay. Now it says I'm unmuted.
let's mute him for a moment. Sorry about that, Joe. Maybe you can unplug your mic for a moment. So, Gary, what's the contract details on the Micah Hyde deal?
I pull it up. I mean, you look at his play compared to – we just saw Rashard Jones. And we saw, obviously, what Eric Berry got. I don't know where he is, but he falls well short of those guys. And I'm assuming he's even shorter than what Aaron Williams got a couple of years ago.
Joe, I unmuted you now, so hopefully it's better.
Okay. Am I – I'm good?
Yeah, you're not choppy like you were before. So you were talking about Micah Hyde and if whether or not you watch Green Bay Packer games.
Yeah, you know, I do. And when I saw that deal from them, I thought that was a great deal. Really under the radar type of move for him. What is he at? What does it say right there? 5-year, $30
million. 30.5, 14 guaranteed. Yeah. I don't know if that's full guarantee, but $8 million signing bonus.
Yeah.
Not bad.
Yeah, no, that's a good deal. He made a lot of plays for the Packers, so I definitely think, you know, all over the secondary, I think he's a guy who can tackle, he can cover pretty well, adds a lot of versatility to that Bills defense. So I saw that, and it's kind of like, damn, but it's a good move for Gary and his Buffalo boys up there. So,
yeah. All right, Joe, I'm going to let you get out of here because you got to do your own show, and I don't like making you late for that. He's Joe Blewett, Joe RB31 on Twitter, Jet Nation Radio on Twitter. Jet Nation Radio is his podcast. Go and give it a listen. And it'll be available tomorrow. Brand new show available for you later tonight or tomorrow morning. However, when you're listening to AFC East Bros, Jet Nation Radio will also be available. So go ahead and give that a download. All right, Joe.
See you guys. I hope to hear from you, Kyle, maybe in a little bit.
Maybe. I don't know if that'll happen tonight, but probably next week.
I see how this works. One-way relationship. All right, guys.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Because I only came on 45 minutes the other night.
I feel you. All right. Thanks, guys.
All right. So, Micah Hyde, as Joe said, very versatile. He'll come down. He'll play slot corner, does it effectively. He's a safety. Drops back in the box. He can blitz well. Does a lot of things for a defense. Sean McDermott values that type of player. Is that Eric Ebron, 85, Gary?
Yeah.
So he's and Eric Ebron's not known as a blocker, but one of the things that Eric Turner had pointed out is that Micah Hyde will struggle every now and then to get off a block.
Yeah. You know what? He's not the biggest safety. He's, like I said, in Sean McDermott's system, they like to use the safeties kind of interchangeable. So they like the quicker guys and they'll line them up sometimes as a corner. They don't need the big Cam Chancellors or Rashad Jones or an Eric Reed. They don't need those type of safeties. But I love the guy. I mean, Kyle, I wish you could play the sound clip of when you were asking me to target guys to go after. I mentioned Micah Hyde, and I also mentioned the other safety we picked up, Jordan Poyer, who I'm a huge fan of. Huge fan of Jordan Poyer's game.
Yeah, I didn't even know who he was, and I would play that for you, but I can't because there's still no freaking update on the software. So what's been happening, just to give you guys – I've been saying this for a couple weeks now – is – the audio is not playing except for at the very, very beginning of the show, which is interesting because I'm allowed to do the show intro. I spoke with our software developer a couple weeks back, and they said that in mid-February, I should expect a software update that's going to fix the bug. However, that hasn't happened yet, so they haven't lived up to their end of the bargain. So if I were to play it now, it wouldn't – Gary and I would hear it, but it would not get recorded. So – hopefully in a future week I can play that, but I will testify to what you said. And for the loyal listeners of the show, Gary did mention those two names specifically when he was talking about guys who he would think would come at a bargain price. Those were two names that he explicitly mentioned.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm a big fan of his game. I think that he's going to work out perfectly. Both of these guys are going to work out perfectly in what Sean McDermott's trying to do. And I'm actually happy that we're doing a change of the guard. I was not the biggest fan of Corey Graham at safety. And Aaron Williams, as much as I liked him as a Bill, he's a liability because of his injury history. It's great having him in the first 4 weeks.
But after that, what are you doing? And every tackle, you got to worry. You have to hold your head and cringe. Is that going to be his last hit or his last hit of his life quality? So I was upset to see Aaron Williams, the man, leave. But Aaron Williams, the player, I didn't want him to play another snap in the NFL. Sorry. So I'm glad that we kind of got these two names.
And it's sad because Aaron Williams is a good player.
He is, but unfortunately, Kyle, I mean, and Nick Collins was a good safety for Green Bay.
And I remember, too. I mean, that was however many years ago, maybe 2011, 2012 offseason, something like that. He won the Super Bowl with Green Bay in 2010, as I said, and he had a pick six in that Super Bowl. I was kind of thinking, like, Nick Collins is good, man. We really could use a safety. Maybe we can go out and sign that guy. But it just never happened.
Yeah. Yeah, I like what the Bills have done this offseason. Not a lot of big names, like we said, not a lot, but they filled some key roles and still not done. I think that they're going to look to sign a few other guys that they have to – because let's face it, Kyle, when you have 28 unrestricted free agents – now, keep in mind, they kept some of their guys in-house. You still got to pick up more. And unfortunately, the Bills only have 7 draft picks, so – actually, I'm sorry, 6 draft picks.
I was about to say 7 standard anyway, but yeah, that being from the Reggie Ragland trade, you guys lost a 4th, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah, we lost a 4th, and we don't have a 7th round either this year.
Do you think that the Bills, I mean, because I had one of our listeners on Twitter the other day said that, you know, what's up? What's the holdup with the Bills re-signing Lorenzo Alexander and Zach Brown? And I said, no, you know, seems on the surface that Zach Brown would be a good fit. He's an athletic linebacker. McDermott really likes athletic linebackers in his defense. But the money just might be something that's a hang up. And I said, they're definitely trying to re-sign Lorenzo Alexander, to which they did. What the heck was my point going to be? So do you think that part of the reason the Bills are kind of like laying low and kind of like, you know, not breaking the bank for Zach Brown is because, hey, listen, we got Reggie Ragland, we got Preston Brown. Let's see what we can do when Ragland comes back.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, Luke, and last year, now keep in mind, completely different scheme and 2 different players, but you got to like Reggie Ragland is more athletic than people give him credit for. You throw on some Alabama tape, that guy can cover in space, that guy can move, not to the extent that Zach Brown can. He's a violent hitter. That's one thing Ragland's known for. That guy, you know, Ezekiel Elliott, I remember in an interview said when they played Alabama or when they played in that playoff game, he said, no one's ever hit me that hard except Reggie Ragland. I mean, Reggie Ragland is a thumper. He would be the Mike backer in the scheme. Now he's not the typical size that Sean McDermott's used to working with, but he could play. Right now, if you look at it, if the season starts tomorrow, you got Reggie Ragland as the Mike, you got Preston Brown as the Will, and Kyle, Preston Brown played as the Will when Jim Schwartz was in Buffalo, and he did pretty well, you would say, that year, his rookie season.
Yeah.
And Lorenzo Alexander would be the Sam. Not a bad group. Obviously, they're not the fastest group, and Sean McDermott's used to having very quick linebackers, but I think you can get by with those guys, and they'd be a pretty formidable group. I'm not saying they'd be the best. They wouldn't be Thomas Davis, Luke Kuechly, but and the kid from Washington who's sleeping my mind, Shaq Thompson. They wouldn't be that group, but it'd be a pretty good pair, a pretty good trio right there.
Yeah, let's get a phone call. Our last caller of the evening, I believe this is the Spin Squad Enforcer from last week. I hope I got that right. What's going on?
Hey, man, how you doing?
Doing pretty good. Did I get it right?
Yes, you got it right. The Friend Squad Enforcer is here. How are you guys doing?
Doing pretty good. Had a little heated exchange earlier, but everything's good now. The love is back. We're brothers after all. Brothers are known to both love and fight.
But over who was the worst? Who has the worst franchise? Bills or Jets? I would think it would be the Jets.
Well, at least we won the Super Bowl, right?
Oh, here we go. You know what? Hey, listen, Finn Squad Enforcer, for the last time the Jets won the Super Bowl, last time the Jets were even in a Super Bowl, the goalpost was in the beginning of the end zone, all right? Just think about that.
Hey, did they?
Black and white TV. Joe Namath was the quarterback. I mean, even though the Jets have won Super Bowl, come on, the Bills went to 4 straight Super Bowls.
That's right, and
that's equal to 1 Super Bowl. And
Kyle wasn't even alive when the Jets went to the Super Bowl. He wasn't even a thought back then.
Do you feel as though you losing those 4 Super Bowls is punishment for not making? Is punishment basically now for y'all because you're the only team that hasn't made the playoffs this millennia? Is it payback? Is it punishment?
You know what? I always say this to my girlfriend that Ralph Wilson, the original owner of the Buffalo Bills, did something wrong. He did something wrong. He double crossed God or something. He did something wrong. God, and this is forever our living hell that we're in right now as Bills fans. So yeah, something went wrong. I blame it all on Ralph Wilson.
I love the Bills. I always consider the Bills the little brother of the division, you know. And you're the reason why Marino probably doesn't have a Super Bowl ring, because the Bills teams during those years was just spectacular.
Yeah, those were great rivalries between Marino and Kelly. And you know what the funny thing is, Kelly and Marino, they grew up about 2 hours away from each other in Pennsylvania, so. They've known forever.
Hey, Enforcer, what do you think? I asked you to come back on this week because I wanted to get your thoughts on Dolphins free agency. You pleased with it so far, or do you think that the Dolphins have maybe overspent a little bit?
I'm loving the moves. A few websites said the Dolphins offseason was like D-grade, and I don't know how to feel about that. I'm so used to winning the offseason and getting an A that I'm not used to getting a D in free agency, you know. And somebody reminded me, you don't win in the offseason. You don't win the offseason. So I'll happily take the S and D's for the offseason for re-signing Kenny Stills to a great contract. I mean, he had four offers from other teams that would have paid him more. He took less to stay with us. Same thing for Andre Branch. People say it was a little bit too much, but 3 years, $24 million. I mean, that's what the market suggests. We also traded.
But is it though? Because we saw Jabal Sheard, who in both Gary and our mind is a better player. He got less. So food for thought with Andre Branch.
I mean, yeah, he got a little. Jabal Sheard got a little less, but I mean, this was Andre Branch's first contract. He was still working, I believe, on his rookie contract that he got with the Jags. So they said there was a good market for his services last year. I mean, he only started 11 games, 5.5 sacks, you know, 2 forced fumbles, you know, and he brought hell of an energy once he took the starting spot for Mario Williams last year. The Lawrence Timmons pickup, I feel was a great pickup.
He really talked a lot of smack. You know, he was going back and forth with Richie Incognito.
Yes, he was. And it slammed his head into the third, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I believe that's right.
Yeah, I remember that picture, yes. I like that. I like that. Don't you like that?
Kirk Cousins does.
The Lawrence Timmons pickup was great, which means we moved Kiko to the outside. And let Timmons work the middle, even though he's coming from a 3-4 defense. The trade for a ham sandwich for William Hayes, who's like a top 10 run stuffer last year with the Rams, that was a great pickup.
Now, why did the Rams want to part ways with him? Because apparently they were going to cut him if they couldn't get a trade.
I don't know. We wanted his services last year. And we was in talks to get him last year from the Rams, but it didn't work out. And this year, I guess, I don't know what the Rams' direction are going. They got a new coach. I believe they say the Rams are switching defenses, so they didn't need William Hayes.
Okay.
I think they switched teams. I believe that's why they let him go.
Wade Phillips is a 3-4 guy, and for the longest time, the Rams have had 4 down linemen, so I guess that makes sense.
I mean, they also cut the Kyle. They had another defensive end named Eugene Sims, and he's traditional 4-3 defensive end, just like William Haynes is. And He got
cut. And they're also trying to get rid of Tremaine Johnson because I guess he doesn't fit in their secondary plans or what they're going to run. So they're trying to get rid of Tremaine Johnson also.
Which is foolish because who's going to trade a draft pick to not only take on a guy with a franchise tag, but he's got 120% franchise tag because this is the second year in a row. I don't see a team doing it. And if a team does do it, they're a fool.
He's going to price himself out of this market.
Yeah.
And the O-line picker we got, Ted Lawson from Chicago, apparently he worked under Gase. He's a center / guard, which is great because just in case Pouncey doesn't come back healthy or misses his 10 games like he usually do.
Which is a guarantee.
Excuse me?
It's a guarantee that Pouncey will be hurt in season. It's guaranteed.
It's like, I don't know. They said that, you know, this is the longest time. He only played 6-5 games last year. They didn't want to rush him back. He wanted to come back. Gase said not to come back. He wanted to be fully healed. So this is the first time in a long time that he'll have this amount of time to heal from whatever procedure that he's going to have or have had with his hip. So I don't know. Yeah, I'm wishing there. He's a top five center in the league when healthy.
Yeah. He's definitely a good player when healthy, but you know that old saying, you're not productive unless you're playing. And Mike Pouncey has a long laundry list of injuries.
Exactly.
So, all right. Finn Squad Enforcer, we fired Mike Tannenbaum. We're gonna oppose you as the GM. Any other names that you're gonna go after in this market right now? Is there any names that you're eyeing up?
In free agency or just looking forward to the draft?
Well, I mean, let's hear free agency. I'm sure we're going to have you on before the draft, so we'll get into that later.
Free agency, if I'm a GM, I'm done looking. I'm done spending, looking for bottom bin players. We put ourselves in the position to not, when it comes to draft, to not draft out of being desperate. You know, we cleared up some holes with veterans and with established veterans and most likely would draft at that spot, you know, so they could teach the rookies. We're supposed to have Don Terry Pullman for a visit tomorrow. I hear he's looking for a multi-year deal. I think we're just going to offer him a one-year prove-it deal.
You guys got very little cap left too, by the way. So you signed Paul. You're going to put all big cap hits in future years for him, I would assume.
Yeah, I mean, we got $19 million left. You know, you want to take away $5 million or $6 million for the draft. So I guess you could safely say we have $13 million left in cap. We also, you know, with the extending of Rashard Jones, that ate into the cap. We also want to get Jarvis Landry extended also this year.
Did the Kiko Alonso deal come through already, Kyle?
No, we put a first-round tender on him.
What was the second-round tender?
Yeah, it was originally tender. It was a second round.
Well, Kiko was a first-round tender. I believe Damian Williams was that second-round tender, the backup running back.
Okay. You might be right on Kyle. Let's look into that right
now. Yeah, I'm pulling it up on the screen. But continue. Go ahead. Yeah, it's first round. You're right.
Absolutely right.
What, Kiko?
Yeah, you're right. It's a first rounder.
Yeah. Kiko's great. A first round tender. I think Damian was a second round tender. We also put a tender on Michael Thomas, but he didn't sign his. But Kiko and Damian signed theirs, and we're still trying to negotiate a long term deal for Kiko.
Now, Michael Thomas is interested because Isab Abdul-Qaddous, who's been highly talked about on the show, is talking about retirement. So.
Yeah, I'm hurt by that. That's a Newark kid right there, New Jersey kid boy right there. He's a Qaddous.
Yeah, he is. And so what is the Dolphins going to be looking at Michael Thomas or the draft? I mean, the draft has some pretty deep safeties in this class.
I know. I mean, this news is kind of new. Like, it's just been around for the last 3 weeks. It popped up that his career may be over. He's a Qaddous. His career is over. So – Nate Allen. Yeah. Signed him to a 1 year deal, $3.2 million. I'm looking forward to the draft. The Dolphins, we've never I'll say we're going on year, maybe 11, to where we haven't had two safeties play together in back-to-back years. It just doesn't happen. I know this will be the ninth pairing with Rashard Jones since he's been here.
Wow.
Wow.
That's an interesting stat. Who was that last safety duo that played together? Do you have that answer for us, Finn Squad and Finn?
Yes. It was, back-to-back years?
Back-to-back years.
I would have to say recently it was – well, they played a full season? Jeez. Oh.
Two seasons together where they were starting two. We're not talking We're not talking Brock Marion days, are we?
I was thinking about that. I'm trying to think if Brock Marion and Jeremiah Bell play together.
I think they missed each other. I was thinking that too.
You
guys had another big box safety
Jeremiah Bell had the smallest legs ever, but his upper body was huge.
Hey, he was now. He could not. He was just an in the box safety. He was an extra linebacker for us.
Yeah,
he couldn't cover.
Same thing. He didn't have any hands.
Yes, he had no hands. He couldn't cover. He was just a tackling machine.
Yeah, he would rack up like 130 tackles a year.
Easy. He had a few Pro Bowl years, like two Pro Bowl years.
Yeah, those were the days.
But what I understand about the Dolphins is they don't really value safety opposite Rashard Jones, so it seems very unlikely that they would go safety in round one, even though you could be looking at Buda Baker potentially being there or Jabril Peppers being there. I don't think that they would go in that direction, to be honest.
Oh, no. We've put value in trying to find a safety to pair with Rashard Jones. Every year, we're picking up a free agent to pair him, whether it was Issa last year, the year before that when we had Lewis Delmas.
Those aren't big contracts, though. Yeah, you're trying to fill a need, but it's not a big contract.
We're trying to fill a need, but then it's like we're not drafting a safety though to like groom. We just keep on picking up free agents. Like I'm tired of picking up free agents, free safeties. I'd rather just finally draft one and groom one and develop. Like from the Chris Clemens to the Jabril Wilsons. Jeez, I mean, I'm so tired of this.
Wow. I haven't heard that. All right, so give us a name. I know we didn't want to talk draft talk, so give us a name that you're looking at in the draft. It doesn't have to be a first-round pick.
First-round pick, honestly, since O-line is not as strength as draft, Forrest Lamp in the first round if he's there.
All right.
And then everything else is defense.
Okay, so who's a safety you're looking at in the draft that you like? Would you go with the Florida product? My favorite safety in the draft is Marcus May out of Florida.
Your favorite safety?
For the Valley. I think you get him in the fourth round.
Okay.
I like that big safety, OB something.
Oh, everyone loves this kid. The kid from UConn.
Yeah, I mean.
OB Melifonwu.
How do you say his name?
OB Melifonwu? Lafonwu?
Oh, that's how you say it?
That kid is a specimen.
You know what's interesting is, him and Byron Jones, both UConn products, both tore up the combine.
I like Byron Jones for the Cowboys.
Yeah, he's played pretty well as well.
Yeah.
I'm about to pull up his measurables because he tore it up.
It's crazy. His measurables are crazy, off the charts.
Yeah, he looks like this safety from UConn. I'm not even going to try to pronounce his name. He looks like he just got off the assembly line for the T-1000 Terminator. I mean.
Yeah, 6'4", so he's got that Cam Chancellor type of height. The weight, let's see, he weighed in at 224, so not quite Cam Chancellor's weight. Arms, 32.5. I mean, that's kind of like edge rusher arms right there. 40-yard dash. That's wow. 95th percentile for safeties. 95th percentile for safeties. 44 vertical jump. That's 99th percentile for safeties. Broad jump, 141 inches, 99th percentile for safeties. So the dude is a freak, no doubt. But
even before we saw these measurables, people were talking about him being like a second round talent in terms of production and play on the field. And that's coming from like a smaller school in UConn, at least in terms of football. So the kid's talented, no doubt. And even Byron Jones, I mean, like, you know, his combine really elevated to him into being round one. But this kid probably had more hype as a player than Byron Jones. So I think this kid's a lock to go round one, I would say. And people are saying closer to like top 20-ish now. So he could very well be there by the time the Dolphins pick. But based on what I know about the Dolphins, I don't see them going this direction.
Yeah, plus, but he's more of a box.
I wasn't even speaking, hey, y'all. Yeah. What is your problem with Tannenbaum? Why do y'all hate Tannenbaum?
I didn't mean to ask you. Well, first of all, Kyle's a Jets fan. So, I mean, his qualm with him is pretty obvious.
All right. So let me ask you a question, Enforcer. When we look at the Patriots off seasons, how would you describe them? What's their philosophy in terms of off seasons? The Patriots.
To pick up some practice squad players and backup players, sign them on the team and make them into, turn them into just another cog in the Patriots machine. Okay. Like, that's all they do.
That's all they do. Would you, true or false statement, they always have the long-term future in their mind? True or false, Patriots?
I guess, yeah. They do.
Okay. And with that approach, doesn't matter. We'll trade away Jamie Collins. We'll trade away Richard Seymour. We'll trade away this player and that player because you know what? We'll trade away Randy Moss. We're worried about what is in the long-term interest for our team. Mike Tannenbaum, he made a couple nice draft picks, but if you really look into it, Those draft picks, Darrell Revis, David Harris, Nick Mangold, DeBrickishaw Ferguson, those were all Eric Mangini's guys. Eric Mangini was a good talent evaluator. Those draft picks had his hands written all over them. So, yeah, you can attribute those draft picks to Tannenbaum because he's the guy who, I guess, had the final say. But Tannenbaum's always been a guy who's been heavily influenced by his head coaches. And he took Mangini's opinions on that and ran away with it. So, if you want to credit him for a potential couple Hall of Fame guys, pump the brakes on that one a little bit. But he's always done things like trade away draft picks for guys like Cromartie, like Holmes, guys who had character issues, motivation issues. And giving away Braylon Edwards, another one, big-time draft capital. We're talking second, third-round picks, sometimes first-round picks. Let's not forget the Jets traded up to get Mark Sanchez. And signing guys to big-time contracts. Let's not forget, too, back in 2011 when Amdi Asamoah was going to hit free agency, he could have went with the Jets because the Jets' offer was right there with the Eagles. He tried to bring him in and pair him with Darrell Revis, even though – I mean, Asamoah wouldn't – I don't know if he would have fit really good into Rex Ryan's. Maybe he would have.
He would. He's a press guy.
Yeah, he I guess he would have. Yeah. But when we saw how old he was in that type of big contract, he was always making the big splash. But if you look at NFL teams, there's no correlation to spending big in free agency and winning championships. There just isn't. And just look at the teams that are good. So Tannenbaum always was willing to forego his draft capital – and invested in guys from opposite teams that, you know, that weren't his own in-home, homegrown guys, guys that were not motivated. And it set the Jets up for a brief run. They were good for 2008 through 2010. They had three productive seasons, winning seasons each year. I mean, shoot, if Brett Favre didn't tear his bicep, the Jets probably would have made the playoffs. But what happened after? 2011, 2012, 2013, you saw one of the worst rosters in the entire league because you didn't have young talent that you can, you were constantly, you know, just, you know.
Now, let me counter with this. Now, I hear all of that, and I understand that. I took that in into all these factors. But you have to realize, once y'all got that the AFC championship, y'all had to switch from building through the draft, right, and start building for now. Y'all thought y'all was ready now. That's what I saw once y'all switched up, because you switched up the draft philosophy. Once Rex Ryan got there, y'all made AFC championship again the next year. It looks as though Mike Tannenbaum and everybody and Woody Johnson switched up their whole philosophy into winning now. So making those bold trades using draft picks, signing these huge contracts to try to see if you can get over the hump. That's what I saw from Mike Tannenbaum during those Jets years.
But
with an owner like Woody Johnson and with a coach like Rex Ryan, he was trying to appease, I can see him doing what he did. But yeah, in this power structure in Miami, he doesn't pick our players. That's Chris Greer. He's our senior VP of football operations. He is not allowed, he's not picking players. He's putting in his input. He has his sports science here, which is like top notch in the NFL on the sports science department. And he relays his information to Chris Greer, and Chris Greer picks the players.
Yeah, well.
Now with our draft picks, this year, last year, like trading those picks for Lante Carew, somebody who, with the resigning of Kenny Stills, is basically still our fourth receiver, and we gave up two draft picks to move up last year to get him. I see that. But at the same time, we had four fifth-round picks. Those four fifth-round picks last year was Ajayi, a starter, Bobby McCain, a starter, Tony Lippett, a corner, slash wide receiver turned into a corner, who's a starter and is becoming his own. I mean, we've hit on our draft picks the last 2 years. Mike T's been here for 2 years. Just two seasons. This is his second offseason.
Hey, listen, I always say this, Kyle. The blind mouse gets the cheese every once in a while. Congrats to Tannenbaum. He hit on some, but you look at last year, he was so gung-ho to bring in Mario Williams. How did that work out for you guys? You know, there's
that was a hit. We had to bring in somebody to replace the hit from Vernon.
Yeah,
we brought in 2 years. DeAndre Branch worked
at $8.5 million a year. Shoot, man, there's probably about $8.5 million other defensive ends that you could have brought in that had the same productivity as him. All I'm saying but Tannenbaum loves older players. He loves signing them to big contracts. Mm-hmm. We've seen this year in and year out from Mike Tannenbaum. He loves making trades. You know, and eventually some of those nip them in the butt. Always it works out in the short term. But in the long run, how does it work out? And listen, with Jay Ajayi, he's a huge hit. But every team knew going into that draft that he was a good running back. The problem was, is his knees. And how long is he going to last? But Mike Tannenbaum, he doesn't care. He cares about winning right now.
I wouldn't care either. Let me ask you a question. So you were saying, okay, well, Tannenbaum, you know, he was trying to appease Rex Ryan, and that's what got him into trouble when he was with the Jets. But that's not a problem here in Miami because of the power structure. And I got to ask you the question. What organization do we know of that has, like, a cap guy, a vice president of football operations, who's got a tremendous amount of influence in the organization, but then you also got another guy who's a de facto GM who's in charge of talent evaluation? Name me one other good winning program throughout the NFL that has that type of power structure that is successful.
I can't really think of any winning franchises that has that type of power structure where you have an executive VP and then a GM and so on and so forth. But here we have it here. This is the first one of this. Here we have it here, and my owner, Steve Ross, doesn't really know much about football. He's still learning the ins and outs of football. So that's why we have that structure.
Well, I mean, listen, just think about the teams that win and always draft well. Let's think about the Steelers. Who is their GM? Kevin Colbert, if I'm not mistaken. Yep. He calls all the shots there. Bill Belichick calls all the shots in New England. Ted Thompson calls all the shots in Green Bay. Ozzie Newsome calls all the shots in Baltimore. These are teams that are always in the playoff hunt, and they're always drafting well every year. But
if you want to be technical, Patriots draft like crap. They're not a good drafting team.
That's false. That's false.
How is that false? Besides defense, which is, you know, Belichick's bread and butter, they don't draft well. The Patriots don't draft well at all.
Okay.
So their entire offense
is free agents.
Chandler Jones wasn't a good draft pick. Dante Hightower wasn't a good draft pick. Devin McCourty wasn't a good draft pick. Rob Gronkowski wasn't a good draft pick.
Jamie Collins
wasn't a good draft pick.
Okay, how about this? My man Finn Scott. Julian Edelman was a 7th-round pick.
How about
Who else on that offense besides the O-line?
Rob Gronkowski.
Every one of their receivers was a free agent pickup.
Rob Gronkowski. Yes, what about James White? How did James White do in the Super Bowl? He was a fourth round draft pick. How about him?
We're really going to be basing 1 year. We're just going to play off of 1 year. James White was very good this year. But I'm not giving them that after 1 year. I need more production. But their entire Brandon Cooks, who they're picking up, free agent pickup. Amendola, free agent pickup. Chris Hogan, free agent pickup. Martellus Bennett, free agent pickup.
Can we say the same for you guys? I mean, Kenny Stills is not an ingrown talent.
Devontae Parker is.
And Dominic Sue is an ingrown talent.
And was Parker a good draft?
Cameron Wake is not an ingrown talent.
You guys
No, he's not. He was undrafted free agent from the New York Giants.
Yeah, and we're the ones that took a flyer on him.
Okay, Keiko Alonso, Byron Maxwell. I mean, your roster is filled with guys that are not from the Miami Dolphins drafts.
Well, I'm saying the whole thing was the Patriots said they draft one. I said besides the defense, most of their offense is free agent pickups.
I'd be curious.
Hey, listen, if we're going to talk about the draft, can we also talk about Tom Brady? I mean, sixth round draft pick, Tom Brady, Hall of Fame, greatest of all time?
Of course.
I'd be curious to find out, Kyle, and Finn's squad enforcement.
What about Jimmy Garoppolo? I mean, I'm no fan of Jimmy, but Jimmy potentially could be a first-round draft pick.
That's if
a team is stupid enough to give him a first-round draft pick for Jimmy.
Well, I agree with that. But anyway, I'd be curious to see who has more of their ingrown talent currently in the roster, the Dolphins or the Patriots.
Rashard Jones, Jay Ajayi drafted. Damian Williams drafted. Pouncey drafted. James drafted. Larry McCunsell drafted. Jarvis Devontae drafted. Tannehill drafted.
Okay.
I mean Rashard Jones drafted. Tony Lippett drafted. Bobby McCain drafted.
But now you're bringing up bad names. Lippett and McCain suck. Don't bring up bad names.
Bobby McCain?
Yes, he blows.
What? Who says who?
Says San Diego Chargers.
I don't know, but Bobby gets on my nerves too.
All game, all up and down the field. Philip Rivers smoked Bobby McCain. Bobby McCain.
Bobby has bad games.
He has terrible games. He has terrible.
He has bad games.
He has worst corner in the league type of games.
Oh no! Oh no! That's your boy Revis.
Well, him too. But at least he had some really good years, though. Bobby McCain's never done that, and I don't think he ever will.
He's not. He's a slot corner.
And he's not a good one.
He's not a number one or two.
He's not but a good one.
Bobby is learning the position. That's why Bobby, in certain games, like you say, he has horrible games. There's other games where he plays above average, especially as a tackler and defending the run. Nothing get past him.
So we're gonna say a slot corner is good now because he's a good tackler.
No, he's serviceable. I mean, the Jets have nobody that's even better than Bobby on their team.
The Jets. That doesn't make your argument good. The Jets stink. That doesn't help your argument.
That's my fourth corner, and he's getting playing time. I mean, what is it? The man plays.
But that doesn't mean he would be a starter on any other team.
Not saying he is, but what he does here, he's serviceable and he's getting better at playing his corner position, the slot position.
You know, a lot of people, and Kyle, I'm not trying to bring up the Jets, but a lot of Jets fans are, oh, we got all these undrafted rookies that are starting, Jalen Marshall and Robbie Anderson. It doesn't mean they're quality wide receivers. It just means that's how stricken you guys. Listen, number 41, Byron Maxwell, I'm telling you this right now. Most teams, he would not be a starter. I'm just being straight up. He's not a good – he's in here. He's your number one corner. Oh, man, I see –
You mean the 15th best corner last year? You're talking about that, Byron Maxwell?
I don't know about you, Captain.
That's
Captain Penalty.
Oh, see, win. Here we go.
Brandon Marshall.
You know what the funny thing? I was just about to say that. When he faced Brandon Marshall, that was the most penalties Byron has had all year is when he's faced Brandon Marshall. So I don't know about these other penalties you're speaking of, because he didn't do that all the other games. I can't agree with you with that. Okay. Byron Maxwell was rated the 15th best corner last year after starting the season horrible, after being benched for a rookie. And after being benched for a rookie,
Finn Squad for. So I got to tell you, my man, if you feel comfortable as those are your corners going in this year, praise to you, man. Good luck with that, because
– You mean the corners that got 17, 18 interceptions last year?
Well, I got to tell you, I mean
– 18 TDs?
Would you agree that one of the reasons why you guys didn't make it further in the first round is your secondary was pretty bad as a whole?
I mean, you do realize that was decimated from injury, right?
That unit needs a big upgrade. I mean, the Steelers.
In his defense, they were decimated.
You do know Byron Maxwell didn't play the last four games. This is the reason why my defense fell off.
But like I said, if you're comfortable with him being your number one corner, that's cool. Please. But I'm telling you right now.
I don't care for Byron all that much. But if you're going to say he's trash or if that's what you're implying, I'm sorry. He was the 15th best corner last year.
As my number one corner, this is what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. If I was a Dolphins fan, I would want to upgrade. That's all I'm saying.
I want to upgrade too. I'm not saying I don't. I want to upgrade.
And I wouldn't feel comfortable with him covering teams number ones. I would not. I'm sorry.
Hey, Gary, who are the San Diego receivers that are working Bobby McCain over? I don't even know these San Diego receivers.
Oh, you got that one kid, Ingram, who's –
my boy Ingram balled on us that game.
Yeah. And then
– make sure you show that interception from Bobby McCain that game too. Make sure you show the interception.
Okay. Hey, I really enjoyed this call. I like the contours. We don't like to shy away from it.
The Finn Squad, unfortunately, needs to call more often.
I am an award-winning trash talking. I'm actually toned down now. I'm like PG-13 for y'all.
All right. Well, that's good. We're children listen to this show.
I know, exactly. That's why I'm like, I'm PG-13. And this is what I love to do. Trash talk about football, each other's plays, everything.
Well, there you go. You and I got to catch a game, man, since you're in New Jersey. We'll catch when the Bills are down.
You should listen to my for the hate week for the Bills. You should listen to the song I made for the Bills.
Damn.
Send it over. I don't know.
All I got to do is dirty like that.
Send it over to me? Because I didn't see it.
I got one for the Bills, Jets, and Patriots.
Send them over. Email them.
I'll also email them to – I sent one to your link last week. Like,
I don't know why I didn't see it. Can you send it again?
Yeah. Okay, I'll send it. I'll send one for each of the teams.
All right, cool. I'm kind of watching this play right now, and DJ Fluker comes up and clobbers Cameron Wake.
Hey, the Dolphins won this game.
Especially if we had, four interceptions that game?
Yeah, I mean, two.
That was one of Tannehill's best games of the year. I think he had a 70% completion percentage.
And he hit five 20-plus yard completions in this game, in the air.
He was bonkers that game. Yeah, Tannehill was bonkers that game.
Hey, you know what, though? A lot of people hate on Tannehill. Kyle and I are not one of those guys. We actually respect his game.
Y'all do? Thank God. I'm tired of going to war with just people in my fan base about Tannehill.
I would take Tannehill on our team any day. I would consider, I don't know how happy I'd be with it, but the 6th overall draft pick that we have this year, I'd consider trading that for him.
You'd have to, Kyle, you got to trade a hell of a lot more than that to get
Tannehill. I know. I promise you that. I'm just saying.
Tannehill on the open market will be bonkers. I've been a staunch Tannehill supporter.
Just like Tyrod Taylor on the open market would be bonkers.
Nope.
But nobody went after Tyrod Taylor.
When he wasn't a free agent.
Exactly.
Nobody went after him. That's why he came back and signed the Chiefs.
Oh, my God. Common sense. You know what? It takes another guy from New Jersey to figure that out.
Joe's from New Jersey. He didn't agree with that. All right.
Joe is not.
Are y'all snowed in? That was me. Are y'all snowed in?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
It's horrible right now. You guys actually got worse than we did. You're a little further up north.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
We got 15.
Yeah, we're about 12 right here, 12, 13.
All right, Finn Squad and Forster, looking forward to seeing those songs. All right, take care, all right? Great call.
Thank you.
Really good call.
Thank you. I love listening to y'all. I love calling in. Y'all have a great night.
You too. Right. Thanks. That was fun. I like when we can go back and forth with people and we give honest, unabashed opinions. I'm tired of some of these podcasts. They're too nice to everyone.
And I love the fact that he said no one was going after Tyron, because that's the God's honest truth, man.
Well, Gary, you know what? He had a couple things right in that call, and he had a couple things wrong. That's one of the things he had wrong.
No, no. You don't hear any – the funny thing is, like I said, Kyle, it probably would have happened if there was that much interest.
Gary, I felt like we started off talking Patriots a lot, but we kind of have not talked about them so much recently. We missed a couple of their signings.
Yeah, name some of them, but Kyle, we did spend a lot of time on Butler and Hightower as well.
Yeah, we did, but we also
and missed Gilmore as well.
Yes, but we missed Daron Harmon, who was a guy who, when we were talking about sleepers, he was a guy that I said, hey, I would like us to get him. He re-signed with the Patriots.
That was a good signing by them.
Yes, he's a very – I mean, he doesn't play maybe 30, 35% of the snaps, but when you factor in what he does and what he does, he's extremely productive when he's on the field. It's just always been a matter of he hasn't been on the field that much. So they got him. That was a great signing, in my opinion. Brandon Cooks, obviously. Dang, I closed down Matt Bowen, former safety. You know, he was talking about shallow crosses that they could run with Brandon Cooks and how they could create a lot of yards after the catch with him. I mean, Brandon Cooks, he's a 4.33 guy. I mean, that's a tenth of a second faster than Sammy Watkins in the 40-yard dash. So Brandon Cooks is lightning fast. And the Patriots offense is all about creating yak. So you have to think that that's a big reason why they wanted him.
Absolutely.
So a lot of the pick formations that they run, it's all about creating yards after the catch. You get the ball in that guy's hands, crazy things can happen. I like that move for them. I mean, is it giving up a lot? Yeah, but he's still got 3 years left, and you figure Brady might be good for three more years. So, you know, Cooks might be able to accentuate Brady's ability because Brady's not a great downfield thrower. Coney Ealy, Gary, that is actually official now. Last we spoke on the phone, it wasn't yet official, but it is official now. The Patriots had exchanged draft picks. What was the exact exchange, Gary?
I don't know. I mean, I didn't know if that article was true or not because it was – so pull it up, but they just found their Jabal Sheer replacement right there.
So the Patriots gave up a second round draft pick, but they got a third in return. Jabal Sheer, Chris Long as well, two edge rushers left, but they got a younger edge rusher who I guess they think could be even better. You know, he was a late first rounder, Gary. Was he a second rounder?
I believe he's a second rounder, Kyle.
Okay, and Gary, this is a big one. Alan Branch, 2 years, $12 million. I get it. He's a nose tackle, but $6 million a year. This guy, he is a top five nose tackle in the league for sure.
Absolutely. He's old. I mean, drafted in 2007, but Kyle, that's a position that you could play a lot older. We mentioned edge guys. We mentioned middle linebackers. That's another one that you could play.
Yeah, and – a couple other guys left, Logan Ryan, Barkevious Mingo, Martellus Bennett signed with the Packers. Good for him. We kind of knew he wasn't going back. No way the Patriots were going to pay top dollar for him. We spoke about Dwayne Allen last week. No need to talk about him again. So I don't got anything else to talk about.
Lawrence Guy, Kyle, that's a good pickup right there that they signed.
I don't know much about him. Tell me about him.
Very active. Explosive defense alignment. He's a 300-pound guy. He's a guy that you can move around. You know, he will fit nicely in that team. He's a guy that doesn't get bullied. He's a guy that can push the pocket. I believe he's a sub-5 in the 40 at 305 pounds. He's got good length, 6'4", from Arizona State. He's definitely going to carve out a nice niche, and that's a good signing. He's a guy that I actually wanted the Bills to go after.
Are we missing – I mean, I know we touched on most of the major guys. The Jets, they had re-signed a couple of their own guys. Corey Lemonnier, guy who you really liked in the pre-draft process. They retained
– Loved him out of Auburn.
Chandler Catanzaro, he struggled much like Dan Carpenter with kicking extra points last year. Jets brought him in. They also cut Nick Folk. So it's going to be interesting to see. And I wouldn't say that it's a lock that Catanzaro gets the job. He's probably going to have to compete with that kicker Ross Martin that the Jets had picked up in as an undrafted free agent last year, who was terrible in the preseason.
But before then, Kyle, before the preseason began, you were very high on the kid.
Yeah, I mean,
he was pretty good from above 50 yards at Duke. So I guess a lot of my excitement about him, Gary, was because I wasn't a Nick Folk fan, never really have been. Because Folk has always been the guy, like, you were always kind of on the edge of your seat. You like, some of the Bills kickers, like, what was that, Lindell? Like, Lindell from under 40 yards, Gary, you were never worried that he was going to miss that kick.
Right.
But Folk, if it's a less than 40 yards kick, which is pretty much automatic in the NFL, I was kind of always like, man, he could shank this. So that's why I was never a fan of him, despite the fact that he had a couple clutch kicks in his career, nicknamed Folk Hero by Rex Ryan. I never really bought into all that. So that's kind of why I wanted Ross Martin to win out. Plus, you could have also cut Nick Folk and got a decent amount of cap back because of that. So I feel like I'm missing one other guy, too, that the Jets re-signed. Lower-end guy, but it's not really big anyway. Any lower-named Bills guys? I know they signed some receiver.
Well, I'll just ramble off some of the names. They obviously, Jordan Mills, their right tackle, which is, you know, he's not – like I said, I'm going to make the same point that I made to our Dolphins enforcer that you can upgrade at that position. And they made it – supposedly it's all over Twitter that they made a pretty good offer at Andre Smith. He just chose to be back with the Cincinnati Bengals. But you're glad to see Jordan Mills back because you know he's familiar with John Miller. They had the number one rushing attack. He could push the pocket. He is very bad in pass protection, but he is good. He's a good run blocker. Mike Tolbert. I love the Mike Tolbert signing, Kyle. The reason I like Mike Tolbert signing is he's going to be used as a power back in the line settings. And that's obviously an area where Shady McCoy is not good at. And you try tackling a guy who's 5'9", 247 pounds. That's going to be a tall task for any linebacker because he's a bowling ball, this Mike Tolbert guy.
Now, even though he's good at that, though, Mike Gillisley is also good on the goal line. So
he is, but Mike Gillisley is also one of those guys. He has a knack for getting the end zone, but he's not a pure power back. You know what I'm saying? He's not that slut. He is.
He's not going to push a pile, but he can truck a linebacker one-on-one.
And not only that, I think Mike Tolbert's a better receiving back than Mike Gillisley.
Yeah, for as big as he is pretty good at that. Did you guys make a run at Juszczyk?
We did, but glad that we didn't get – we actually signed the fullback from Atlanta, Patrick DeMarco.
Yeah, and he's pretty good from what I understand.
He's good. We signed Philly Brown, a wide receiver from Carolina.
Yeah.
I know. These are not – Steven Hauschka, Kyle. Steven Hauschka is a Buffalo Bill now.
He's okay. Not bad.
Better
than Dan Carpenter.
We signed Ryan Davis, a defensive end from the Cowboys, who fits kind of that 4-3 mold. We signed Jeremy Butler, who has familiarity with Tyrod Taylor at their days in Baltimore. He's a wide receiver. And by far the biggest acquisition for the Buffalo Bills this offseason is none other than one Vladimir Ducasse.
You guys just got the best-looking player in the NFL.
The most handsome. I got to tell you, seeing him up at that podium – he is a mountain of a man. He is a rather large individual, big, broad shoulders.
Oh, yeah. He's a huge
dude. And one thing that always sticks out in my mind, Kyle, you and I were talking about, it was a game between the Patriots and the Jets. This was many years ago. Vlad Ducasse got the start, I think, because Slauson was injured. And it was the game where the Jets dominated the Patriots. I forget which one. It was either a playoff game or – it was in 2010. It was his rookie year.
Okay, well, the Jets did beat them in – or, well, the week two, they beat them like – I don't know. They beat them like 28-14 or something like that. So I guess it might have been the week two.
One play that stood out to me was when Vlad Ducasse pancaked Wolfork. And we were talking about – hey, I said to – I called you on the phone. I was like, hey, I see Vlad Ducasse got the start. And you're like, yeah, he pancaked Wolfork really bad. I said, yeah, I saw that. So that always stuck in my mind that guy could be a mauler. He has a mean streak to him. He's a big guy, but he's familiar with Juan Castillo from their days in Baltimore, and he's pure depth signing. So I'm not overly excited about Vlad Ducasse.
4-year deal, so he's gonna be around for a while.
Three-year deal.
Oh, 3-year. Okay. All right, that's gonna do it for us. Gary, he's on Twitter AFC_EastBro. Gary. He's too Hollywood to answer you back, though. I'm on Twitter at AFC East Bros. Email the show, afceastbros@gmail.com. We're on YouTube. We're on iTunes. We're on Stitcher. We're all over the place. Let us know what you think about the show. If you can leave us a 5-star rate and review on iTunes, we greatly appreciate that. And we look forward to continuing to talk a little bit more about free agency and then really, really, really getting into the NFL draft. So for Kyle, for Gary, I'm Kyle signing off, and we'll see you next time.